We have a continued notice of intent hearing, actually, yeah, hearing for 270-0675, 364 Lowell Street, May 26th. Lot 157 Jameson. It's being held under the Wetlands, Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section, is that 70? The meeting will be held by the applicant making information, provide information, and if there are any questions, please direct those to the chair. And at this time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my right.
David Panett.
Kazika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Al Couillard.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
I believe we have Mr. Manuel, Bill Manuel, here as representative of the applicant.
Yep, Mr. Jameson is here as well. We had a long discussion at the last meeting. We submitted some additional information last week to address point by point the information that Mr. Tironi had laid out in a memo to the DRT commission for that DRT meeting. You all have that information. We went through and I gave you a point-by-point response and the page and document of where I made those revisions. And we also submitted to you a revised set of plans that really just dotted I's, crossed T's in relation to the items that were suggested on the on Chuck's list. And I submitted to you a revised wetland and buffer zone mitigation plan. Again, just dotting I's, crossing T's, being consistent with the plans, the memo, and the other documents. So beyond that, I don't have anything else to add.
Any questions from commission members?
Did any of your applications include the test pits? Because I was looking through the file in preparation in anticipation of the notice of the order of conditions being drafted. I didn't see test pit logs.
If you scroll that plan right up there, Chuck, there you go.
So there are 10 test pits.
Yep, these test pits here document where the recharge areas were.
Okay, which are you talking about the logs, the boring, like the depth profile logs?
Yep.
So
the other test pits would be in the drainage report.
Did we receive a copy of the drainage report?
We did submit a full copy
right.
to the commission. We submitted a summary to the commission members, and the drainage is being reviewed by the town engineer. What we just in summary, it's basically all sand out there, A-type soils.
Was part of the wetlands delineation identifying the predominance of native species of existing acclimated species?
Every time we do a wetland delineation, we take into account the soils and the vegetation community.
Okay, but was, I mean, like an exact listing of the species that are there? Because part of what I'm anticipating in the restoration area is a continuation of the existing habitat.
Mm-hmm.
And that said, what I'm expecting to see that kind of wasn't, you did go through and you did clarify a number of things, but I didn't see in the wetland restoration area any sort of species list of what's going to be planted, you know, how much wetland soil is going to be laid in there, you know, that some sort of understanding of what's going to be, what it's going to look like exactly
afterwards. This document here?
Right.
Has a planting schedule. Appendix A.
Okay. There's certain things in the appendix schedule that say that you're going to, it mentions tree species, but then it says shrubs. So I think there's room for confusion in the tables.
This document, this table, tells you exactly what's going where, how many, and what species, and what size, what distribution within that those areas.
Yeah, I have it.
All right. So, Bill, you never provided
so
anything
with
DEP
plot
sheets?
Those were provided way back with the original ANRAD.
Okay.
Yeah, the line was never part of this. The line was already...
Right, established. So, but they did provide DEP data sheets.
I think it's a typo.
So that would have... the predominant species that
sure,
that characterize that wetland.
At that plot location.
Yeah. Are you consider it fairly homogeneous throughout?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Right. Nothing unusual here.
Something that I'm if it's not since it something that I'm anticipating to add if it isn't already something that I'm anticipating to add in the order of conditions is details like microtopography, installing the trees in the replication area in clusters and sort of in kind and not as like a homogeneous grid. Do you know what I mean? So that when all said and done in this wetland is hopefully working, this additional wetland is working, which is the goal of, I think, which is your intent proposing it and our goal in approving it, that it works effectively. Some things I've learned lately is getting that wetland functioning effectively and purposefully is actually very challenging. That there's, especially on that upper limit, there tends to be die-off because wetlands tend to be flagged along the drier edge of a wetland. So, you know, I just took a closer look at it, and okay, so maybe it's a typo and help me understand. So on area for area 3 and area 4, the tree policy mitigation planting along the lot lines and between the wetland mitigation area and the construction road. So you list some tree species, and then at the end of the plants column, it says a total, and then it says shrubs. Do you know what I'm saying? So if this is used as a construction document, I mean, we know that maple is a tree species. And hopefully the people working on site also know that those are tree species. But just for consistency and for enforcement and clarity, you know, little things like that I think have potential to
when we're finally signing off
and we get there and we say what about those 6 red maples? And somebody decides they really wanted shrubs. You know what I mean? It's just for the sake of clarity and moving forward consistently.
At that size specification, that comes out of your tree replacement policy, those are shrubs. You're right. They will mature to be trees, but at that size, they're shrubs.
Oh, so that's why that word was put in.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Now, the other thing I wanted to just talk about, you mentioned clustering.
Would you call them saplings? I'd call them saplings. I wouldn't call them shrubs.
No, technically, a sapling is something less than 3 inches in diameter and more than 20 feet tall, if you're going with a DEP classification. Anything less than 20 feet tall is a shrub.
Okay.
you can call him whatever you like. It's,
we can split sampling.
With respect to,
now I understand.
With respect to clustering within that replication area and microtopography, it's something that sounds nice on paper, but it's only 2,500 square feet. You're not going to have, if you do some microtopography, you're not going to have the space to grade out these little hummocks that you envision and cluster plants. You're just not going to have that space to do it. So our standard that we put down as our goal for success is that we want 75% coverage of wetland plant species over the entire replication area. If you had something bigger, yes, you can have little microtopography areas, and I'm talking bigger, like perhaps a half acre or something like that, or a quarter to a half acre. When you get these very small areas, one little microtopographic hummock might cover 500, a quarter of what you're trying to vegetate. So, respectfully, I don't think that's going to work.
When I look at area 3 and 4, I kind of understand, Anika, where you're coming from. You've got it 10 feet on center. Could you do that off center?
Absolutely. And those areas, Chuck, would you please scroll down, please?
So, Anika, if it's off center, it's
right.
No, it's
right. We don't want this looking
areas
engineered. We want to design
four,
it to look natural.
As soon as I find my laser. Anyway, areas 3, this is area 3, this little area right in here. There is no room to offset.
Okay.
Area 4
right.
is the tree buffer
right.
around the perimeter.
Okay. Well, we retract that.
Can I ask just another follow-up question? For the operation and maintenance plan, there's a reference to rain gardens LIDs, and there's also a reference on these plans to BMP LIDs. But if you look on like sheet, what was it, 3? sorry, forgive me. Sheet 4. Oh.
Are we on
the notes. The notes for the above the wetland restoration detail on sheet C3, it says, note 3 says for the LID 1 through 5 details, see sheet C15. But I was only given up to sheet C7.
All right.
Yeah. So if I don't receive the LID details, those are going to be required before construction begins as part of the
order.
Yeah,
we caught one of these areas. There's the planning board plan set, and there's the Conservation Commission plan set. The information, the details are here in the plan set.
That
you have.
Help me find them.
Go to sheet C7.
C7
is the detail sheet, utility details sheet. C6 has the details for the infiltration basin, the roof drain infiltration system.
Okay, so the BMP detail on C6, that's for all the BMPs? That's for each BMP LID area?
Yeah, and then the LIDs.
Is that true?
You are correct. The LIDs on lot 2, you're right that they're not in this plan set.
Because a piece of me was thinking, well, if those are bioretention rain gardens, how are they getting fed water?
By overland flow.
Oh, okay. From the driveway or
driveways,
the road
yes.
or the.
If it's a little rain garden feature bioretention area, it's just from the driveways or the lots themselves.
So it's
the road has its own feature, which is the larger.
Which is BMP1.
Right.
Okay, so each of these. So, like for example, BMP LID 1 on C3. It looks removed distance-wise from the driveway. I mean, I understand LID 2 and LID 4.
On which lot are you speaking?
The one just almost 100% out of the 100-foot. Lot 4. First lot on the right.
Yes. You can see the grading is indicated here to kind of pick that water up that's coming off the driveway. See how that's graded there?
Right.
So that's how the water's going to get there. It's going to go overland flow into that feature.
Just function-wise, since that's out of the 100 feet, would it make more functional sense to move it close to the driveway?
I think it's six of one, a half dozen of the other. I think you'll end up with more maintenance of it if it were closer to the driveway.
More maintenance.
If you have more overland flow, you have more opportunity for anything to infiltrate into the ground before it gets to this feature. Any sediment is going to get lost in the lawn.
Right, I guess part of me is thinking, so will all the water. And the water won't actually
That's fine.
Get to the...
That's fine.
But then that won't function as a...
Yeah, well, there's one at Raven's Dental. I walk through there across the tracks all the time. It's not necessarily all wetlands plants, is that correct?
That's correct.
It's a depression, and it serves as kind of like a, you know, like to take flood, you know, as a flood retention.
So then, as a follow-up, these LID areas, how are they going to be visibly demarked from the lawn?
We don't have anything
specific.
They are meant to be subtle features. There will be vegetation in them. We don't have anything specific that demarcates them from the lawn. But we do have, you see in the O&M plan post-construction, there actually is a homeowner sort of document that explains what this feature is and how they are supposed to maintain it on an annual basis.
And so... So that is... So the actual maintenance for the BMPs will be weeding, refreshing the mulch, wood mulch or landscape mulch. The homeowner can aerate. No, that's the lawn. They can apply fertilizers to these.
Right. Once they're established, they're really meant to be low maintenance.
Are they required in here to maintain the native vegetation in this as part of that?
I don't recall if there was something very specific to that point. You could certainly add that as an order of conditions, replace any, if it's not in there, replace any lost vegetation in the LIDs.
And not mow it.
Right. Shrub.
I don't see that in here.
Well, it'd be shrubs.
Are you putting shrubs in all those LIDs? I thought it was going to be subtle.
There's supposed to be plants in there.
Oh, okay.
I think the detail says a wetland seed mix.
Okay.
So there's shrubs in there too?
Then I stand corrected.
So that's the thing I'm thinking, wetland seed. So they're going to be full of wetland plants. That's why I was thinking it should have a source of water.
Hold on a minute.
What?
You can't be in lot 3 and 4. Those LIDs shouldn't be wetland plants. I mean, they're not.
Not wetland.
Is that what we're talking about?
Yeah.
Well, there's one detail for
there.
All the LIDs.
I think you're talking about the detention basin when you're.
No, if these features are collecting water on a regular basis, basically every rainstorm or anything more than an annual rain event, they are going to be periodically saturated, so they will support some sort of...
So the LIDs and lawns are planted.
Yep.
So are these going to have shrubs or not, just the wetland seed?
Where's the detail you're looking at?
C6.
Are you looking at the BMP detail?
Yep.
You're looking at the BMP number one detail.
Okay, so where's BMP?
I told you earlier it's not on here.
Oh, okay. I thought you had said earlier that this represents all the BMPs.
The LIDs, I told you there wasn't a detail for the LIDs.
Are we going to get that detail?
It's not on the plan set, so if you would like that, yes.
Okay. I'm in favor of that. I don't know if anybody else has any comments or objections to that.
I apologize. I was not here at the last meeting. Were these questions raised at the last meeting, Anika? No.
No,
were they,
not to my
were they
memory,
things that
but...
were omitted? Or...
Chuck had a pretty lengthy list.
We had a large list.
Right. I did see
I had a list. We started writing the order of conditions, mm-hmm. and I think this is where the additional questions are coming from.
We've asked Anika to kind of take a look at that, and put some detail to the order of conditions along with Chuck, and I think those are her questions. So she's getting into the weeds, if you will,
literally
about that.
I would also very much like to see the test pit logs for the remaining six test pits, just across the site.
Okay, Chuck,
do we have those from what you said from the original?
They're in the drainage calculations.
In drainage calculations to this
the full
order?
Set. Yes.
Okay.
And Dave, I think didn't you have a question about the slope right at the base of the wall?
I did. I had the wall that's going to be on the outside of in the replication area, that wall that's there.
Yep. Can you do the best one? See it on?
Yeah. In the detail, it was going to be, it was stabilization that was mentioned that was going to be put on that slope. And that's a fairly steep slope that's there. And I'm sure that's going to be something that once you get the bottom of the wall, you'll know better what the finished grade is going to be. But is there going to be any kind of stabilization when you put the organic soil mix down there to stabilize that until the plants and the shrubs get ahead on them? Like a mat or something that is going to stabilize that organic fill.
Yeah, right now we don't have anything for that specific area. If we get it graded out and we find out that we need something, we'll put matting in there. Okay. It's such a short segment, it's not wide at all, so you're not going to get any water travel running across there. So we'll take a look at it.
I was just concerned because of the grade of it, that's all.
Yep.
You get one gully wash of rainstorm and
there's always that
disappear.
That limbo time from the time you initially grade it to you get the seed stabilized, and there's always some work to do, some patch of work.
Is this some wetland seed mix that you're going to put in there? Is this intended
no,
to be?
No, not in that area, because that's going to be an upland area.
Oh, it is?
This, if you're speaking of this
right
area
there,
right in there, that's going to be an upland area.
Isn't there
this is the
in
this is the limit of the wetland creation, so this
right.
is going to be
cross,
a wetland berm.
The crosshatched area, isn't there going to be the wetland seed mix in there? In that crosshatched?
Here, yes.
Yes.
Yep.
Is
so then it gets higher and grades up to that road. And we're actually putting in some shrubs in here for your tree replacement policy.
Is that where you're going to put the wetland seed mix in there? Is that going to be hand sown, or is that going to be intended to be type of seed?
That small an area, we'll just hand sew it.
Okay. Another question about that?
Do you have the rate of how much you're going to put in that area?
Whatever the manufacturer supplier is, Let me see what I recommended.
Is that from New England Plants?
You know, that's one supplier, and there are others. You know, I like to deal with Pearson Nurseries out of Biddeford, and they have a similar product. Actually, in this area here, I have not specified any wet mix. The wet mix goes in here, but in this area here, I have not specified that. And the reason is I've been experiencing when you put the wet mix down, it tends to grow very vigorously, and you'll get 6 foot tall herbaceous vegetation at the end of the first growing season, and it overtakes the wetland shrubs. Try something different here. We do have a monitoring protocol where I owe you reports at the end of the first and second growing season, and we do have a specification that we're looking for 80% plant survival of the plants that go in there, and we want 75% coverage of wetland plants. So if I don't get that at the end of the first growing season, I may end up having to put some seed there, but initially I want to try to not choke shrubs out.
When that new wetland topsoil comes in, how is it going to be? What's going to be the standard for that soil, and how's it going to be compacted there?
Well, the work will be under my direction. The standard, or the composition, if you mean, is 70% sandy loam and 30% leaf mulch mix. And that's in the plant spec. I like to put the material in by dropping it in with an excavator bucket, and I don't like to compact it at all. It will compact by itself, but if you drive over it and compact it, I don't like the consistency of the upper layer.
Bill, when you get the leaf mixture, is that pasteurized, or how do you prevent any invasives in that? Where do you get that?
You go any landscape place, typically will have access to that. So it's going to be up to the contractor to pick up that leaf mix.
Mm-hmm.
And no, I didn't talk about pasteurizing it or heating it or anything. We're going to have to, if it's leaf mix, then we shouldn't have much of a problem with invasives coming in.
Thank you for all that. The only question I had is when if there is a big storm, the wetland replication area, put the shrubs in, you've got the organic mix. What keeps it from all washing away? Is it sloped in such a way that the high water runs around it?
No, it's intended to be to match the grade of the adjacent wetlands, and it's very flat.
Yeah.
So the stream channel is out here. Yes, you'll get some backwatering in here if it's a high, intense rain event. But as I said, there is that limbo time.
Yeah.
We do have erosion controls that we're going to put along the outer edge, and that'll stay there until that surface gets stabilized. We'll also have erosion controls along the upper edge here, and you know that should, the upper edge should stop any erosion from run in, and the erosion controls on the lower edge will stop any sedimentation from running out or having a high velocity water flow coming in. So.
And how long will that stay in place, the erosion control on the lower side?
Until you say we can remove it.
It might be something that.
Couple of growing seasons is typical, but standard language is we'll remove it when you say we can.
Okay, all right, thanks.
Can you remind me, if you're familiar with it, how the septic tank's going to be decommissioned?
Sure. It gets pumped out if there's anything left in it.
Yeah.
And then you backfill it with what they call Title V sand.
Clean sand. Clean. So it's backfilled, so it's pumped out, and then it's backfilled, and that's it?
Yep.
Okay.
If there's any components there, they crush them or remove most of, you know, there's probably, if they tried to remove them, they're just going to fall apart anyway.
So during the refurbishment of the house, what about any pipes or drains that lead to it?
Well, you're going to reconnect the house to the municipal sewer, correct, Dave?
Yes.
So at that time, you're going to disconnect the plumbing that heads out to the old system. Typically, they'll put a plug in the pipe, put some concrete in the pipe.
There's a whole Board of Health protocol for that, isn't there?
I'm not a Title V expert, so whatever the Board of Health requires, that's what they're going to do.
Right, right. Just wanted to get some sense. So when that gets pumped out, that's going to be trucked off-site?
Yep.
Yep. I don't think I had any other questions.
Any other questions from the members? Or Chuck?
I do. I just had a couple of questions. So in the cul-de-sac, where does the water run off at the front? Over that retaining wall area?
No.
Does it come all the way down to the detention pond?
Everything is graded to the low point here, and there's a collection point, and it goes into the basin.
Right. So everything's kind of flowing down through here, in that spot.
The road is its own system.
But it also goes to that spot. So is anything off of lot 4 and 3 going to come into the road?
That's what these features are there for. That's what each of those features is there to pick up anything that runs off the driveway.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're going to have... All right, so but what gets into the road is going to go down into the detention area, right?
Yes.
But before it gets there, it's going to go through that sump. Is that what's happening?
So there's a catch basin at the low point here, and then, there's a concrete sediment forebay system here before it actually spills out into this infiltration area.
So that's not a proprietary system, right? That's not like a storm system.
Correct.
So the maintenance that goes on with that detention pond is inside the pond itself.
Well, the maintenance should be limited to any sediment that's in that catch basin sump or the sediment forebay. Again, you might have to replace some plants or, make sure you have a uniform.
You don't
cover.
Expect things to spill over in a swarm into that detention pond?
Oh, we do. That's what it's there for.
With sediment in it?
No, it shouldn't be.
Because when the town takes this over, it's not something I've seen them do in the first place. I mean, you have a sump, but you don't have a storm scepter. Was there a reason why you didn't put a storm scepter there to get that extra little bit of scrubbing out of the water? And then that's also something that the town knows how to take care of.
Yep. Yeah, there is a good reason. They cost a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
And we were able to achieve the TSS removal using this system here.
So
you have excellent soils on site.
You're getting 80% out of that one system.
Yes. We have excellent soils on site. It's designed to infiltrate a 100-year storm event. So there should be no outflow in a 100-year event.
7.1-inch storm.
I did remember that SDEP talked to you about that, and you explained the system, and then they became okay with it.
Right.
So that sedimentation chamber, that's is that the head wall detail on C7? So it's a 500-gallon sedimentation chamber frame.
I don't see that on my C7.
Oh, yeah, it's right here. It's the tan.
Oh, right there.
The tan thing, bottom right.
Yes. Looking at it, I can see the forest for the trees. Yep, so you see the catch basins drain into that drain manhole, and then it goes into that, you're right, the head wall detail with the 500-gallon sedimentation chamber.
And it looks like, so those two, because I'm very technical. Those two purple squares that feed into the drain manhole are from what?
These?
Yeah.
Catch basins.
Those are two catch basins one in front of lot four and the other immediately opposite. So you're catching both sides of the road because it's going to be curved.
It'd be crowned, yes.
Be crowned. I'm with you. I'm just, it's a lot of fine writing on these plans. I'm just trying to make sure I understand.
So, Anika, I'm going to finish my stuff. Okay, are you all set?
Yeah, I think I am.
Okay. So the replication, for the order, so it might be pretty quick answers. So the replication area is 1:1?
No, it has no particular ratio because there's no altered wetland. It's we selected an area that was we deemed to be the historic fill,
mm-hmm.
and that's what it came out to be.
So whatever you take out in historic fill, you'll essentially replace with
wetland.
So it is kind of 1:1. The Japanese knotweed, are you committed to managing the Japanese knotweed between Lowell Street and the MBTA culvert?
Yes, we changed our plan to say that we were going to grub everything out.
I assume you're not using level spreaders anywhere in this. You don't have anything like that.
I'm not aware of any level spreaders.
I didn't see any. So when that comes over the top of your detention basin, there's nothing on the inside except for wetland.
Well, there shouldn't be any outflow to that basin.
Okay. I just wanted you to go over how you got 80% on one system, just so I can have it in the record. Let me get back to that panel.
ESS?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not the expert on the drainage, but typically the first thing they do is provide street sweeping, which gives you 10%. Then the deep sump catch basin is worth 25%. Sediment forebay is another percentage. I don't know that exact amount. Then the infiltration basin probably achieves something close to 80%.
Street
sweeping, deep sump catch basin, sediment forebay, infiltration basin.
Sediment forebay.
Correct.
Do we have a detail on that on 7?
C7.
Have you looked into that?
We were just looking at it. And that's the detail we were looking
at. Oh, that's the 500 gallon?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I just needed that. I actually don't have any question, but I have access to Bill during the week, so I'm all set.
I'm sorry. I said I was done, but do you have some sense of how much wetland topsoil you anticipate to put in that knotweed area?
No, not at this time.
But a minimum would be plantings.
I think we said 4 inches after we grubbed the area out and restored the grade. If you're asking me what's my cubic yards, I don't know, but inches.
I'm just trying to get a sense of the profile.
Yep.
So a minimum of 4 inches to establish wetland
in the
plants.
Upland areas, you don't want much more than that. In the wetland areas, we do it a little thicker to get a deeper organic layer. But the uplands, you don't want much more than that, just mushy.
I just wanted to get a sense. Thanks. Yep.
Are there any questions from the community? Yes, please. And did you sign in?
I did. I've asked this a couple of times. I don't know that it's been answered satisfactorily, but the purple area there, you're saying that's a retention?
Which part?
Is that what that is? This is the large one on the bottom?
Yep.
Yes. Where is snow removal going to take place? Like, where is snow going to, is it going to hit into this retention base? Because my fear is it's going to be dumped over that 4-foot wall at best. If it's treated, if there's any kind of vegetation on the other side, we're going to be looking at dead plants, because you see what it does on the highways. It just kills everything it touches. It did that to all of our lawns about 2 feet in a couple of years ago on our lawns. Where will the snow removal, where will any snow be dumped on that street?
Because
if it's dumped over there and it's treated, it's also going into an area that...
So that's been answered a couple of times.
I've asked it a couple of times, but they haven't answered it to my...
Okay, so the answer, as I understand it, is the snowplow comes in off Lowell Street, goes straight all the way in, and pushes it all through the cul-de-sac.
Okay, and where does it end up getting dumped? I mean, it's obviously
on
not
going to
be parked in front of people's houses.
Is that right, Bill?
Yep.
On the lawn.
You're at the end of the cul-de-sac, you get the snow.
And it turns around. Does the truck turn around in there and then...
Comes back out.
Back out?
Has to turn around.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't turn around.
They just push,
back up, push,
and then they turn around and come back out.
So it is possible that it's getting dumped over that wall.
In a big storm, some snow might come over that wall.
You know, I think with the mounting, as the plow goes by, I don't think you can help, like on the edge, a little bit of something happening, right?
But
we have a plowing expert here.
If you put yourself in the plow truck, there's two things you're going to hit. You're going to hit a granite curb, and then you're going to hit a bunch of maple trees. So there are physical barriers for the plow, visual barriers.
Right. Don't forget, all these green circles are 3-inch caliper street trees as well. So the edge of that road is pretty well defined.
And there's a survival plan for those,
I think those are 100%. And that's a planning board requirement, I believe. Street tree dies, you replace it.
And anything in that purple, I mean, if there's die off, I mean, isn't there, we talk about 80% survival and monitoring for 2 years?
Right, the 80% was more in here, but this is that's sort of a different animal. We want like 100% coverage in there.
It's grass, right?
Yeah.
That's not like seed mix.
I thought
it was
grass.
The purple.
That's the wetland mix.
It'll be herbaceous, low growing.
So I don't know if that helps, but so it's going to be part of the ORT conditions we write that they have to meet sustainable growth in those areas over a number of years. So we're going to stick with this project and oversee it until plants sustain in those areas.
What about when we do have a lot of snowfall? This year was kind of a pass, wasn't that bad of a year, but something like 2 years ago when we got 100 inches, my fear is that snow is going to get, now you're saying 100-year storm, this retention thing can hold. If you have more snow being added into that area, that's a lot of water, and it's going to melt somewhere, and you're saying that's the upland, so we have to be on the downslope from that.
When you get 110 inches of snow like we did 2 years ago, a lot of things go wrong. This is a very reasonable plan for plowing. We were all on our roof shoveling, houses caved in. We could lose a couple of trees if we get 110 inches of snow here. But you also have a bunch of neighbors living on that cul-de-sac in very expensive homes who are going to want it fixed up.
Excuse me?
What did you say? Sorry,
I
didn't hear.
You're also, if we have a few trees die, people that live on that street and their nice and expensive homes are going to expect them to be repaired and replaced by the town as well, or they're going to do it on their own.
My concern is people in very expensive homes. I don't have an expensive home, but there is going to be some kind of change in that wetland. Say however you want with this retention thing, but you have a wall there that I can guarantee you that plow is going to dump right over that wall.
Well, you can't guarantee that, and honestly, today what you have is historic fill and invasive species in there, and so you're going to be a lot better off after this
wetland replication than you are today in that spot.
Okay.
So when you're dumping snow over that wall right there, you're going to be dumping it into a wetland. That's going to become a jurisdictional wetland because it was historic fill on top of that. In some towns, they do not allow snow to be dumped into the wetlands. Were you guys asked to put a railing on that side to deter the snow plows from, and I actually didn't even know they plowed that way, Bill. I thought they went in and came around and went back out again, but I appreciate you telling me that. Is there anything preventing you from putting a railing there?
I would think there's going to be a guardrail on top of that wall.
It's not in the plans, though.
Yeah, I mean, it may be one of those. There's 1,000 details on this little plan, so I mean, it may be one of those that was omitted, but I can't believe it would have got past the planning board without a guardrail on top of that wall.
So you're okay with the guardrail? If
sure.
Okay. And the other question is, if they were to direct the snow into that detention area,
which one, Chuck?
Sorry. The biggest one, the final one.
Yep.
Would that be a problem?
This one here?
Yes.
Well, that's on a straightaway. So
if it happened, I mean, is it a problem to have snow go, if it was filled up to the top and the snow melted out in the summertime?
Remember, this is designed.
Some plants might get crushed.
We had 100 inches of snow 2 years ago, and it crushed every plant. And then if it's herbaceous, it's already dead for the season. So it just comes back up the next year.
So it would be hard to do on a straightaway, but if snow got into this area, it's not a problem.
It's going
to
look very flat when the snow melts, and then the herbaceous plants are going to resprout that year, and you're going to have new growth. Now, remember, this is sized to accommodate 7 inches of rainfall in a 24-hour period, whatever that number is, 7.1, you're not going to get melt-off at that rate. It's going to be very slow and gradual.
Yeah.
Okay. Do I have a motion to continue? Where are you guys with... Is it? You're not finished with your permitting, right?
No, we incorporated plan revisions based on this last set of revisions. We had a DRT meeting. We incorporated everybody's revisions from that meeting. We now incorporated the stuff that came out of the last Conservation Commission meeting. We would like to close the hearing tonight. We don't believe that there's going to be any substantial changes going forward with the Conservation Commission, with the Planning Board.
If we didn't close, then more comments could come in during the review of the Order of Conditions. That's the only reason. Correct, Chuck?
What are we waiting for? What's outstanding?
I just think,
Chuck, I'm open
to our comments have been answered, I think, sufficiently. We've spent a lot of time. Anika and Chuck have spent a lot of time going through all the information that came from the last meeting.
I would just say that I remember 44 Roman Lane when it was closed, and everyone wanted to ask the owner some questions when we were reviewing the order of conditions.
I agree. I think
so you asked me what an example is. That's the example I could bring up. Now, usually at this point, we have no more questions. You close the hearing, you write the order, and then you can still discuss it yourself and issue it. And there'll be no input from anyone except the commission. So those are the two options. Did you feel like the neighbors...
Sir?
But before you close, I do have one quick question.
What's your name, please?
John Russell, 23 Plymouth Road. I guess two questions. Any significance to the dots
lower there, extending into my backyard significantly? Or is that just...
You mean
the blue line?
The broken line here, the square, the big square in the center coming off the cul-de-sac.
It's a sea of detail.
No, to the left square.
That
square, yeah.
That's just the same as this. It's an indicating that's an enlargement.
Okay. Yeah, look at, it's on the plans.
Okay.
That's what that is.
Not my main question. My main question is more of a process. What are the checks and balances involved in making sure that everything is being done to the specs, the very exacting specs that are here? We've all heard stories, corners get cut, all of a sudden the purple area is half the depth that it ought to have been. Who's involved in overseeing it on the town side?
With respect to the wetlands, which we have jurisdiction, wetlands jurisdictional areas. There are time periods where our administrator, Chuck Taroni, is called onto the site to review the work, the replication area and some of the and the grading and the soil erosion sediment control. There would also be, in this case, an environmental monitor as when they do the replication areas. There are reports by that monitor as to the viability or the health of the plants that have been planted in those areas. We talked about that at length tonight.
As-built.
Yeah, and then, there are inspections from our town engineer with respect to the stormwater runoff, that infrastructure. And I'm not sure about the other infrastructure that's built. There are our building inspectors that go out and inspect the viability of the homes. Anything else, Al, that you can think
just
of?
Just the as-builts, man. Most of that stuff doesn't have to do, a lot of that end stuff doesn't have to do with conservation, but there's a lot of checks
there
and balances.
Okay, because a lot of it is
they
outside.
They don't just get approved and go away and do what they want. We're watching them every step of the way.
And so part of this, Chuck, before all, the certificate of compliance, they won't receive occupancy for...
No.
No.
We do not hold up occupancy.
For these.
So we don't issue partial certificates of compliance, but unless you have a 20-year-old order out there. But occupancy we can't hold up. But we would ask for the as-built plans, the Form 8A, and an engineer's letter, kind of helping us understand where the project is at this point, and then we allow occupancy. But we hold up on the certificate of compliance, which would be important to every new homeowner. We also have a bond for our work, which is basically a bond that would only allow us to stabilize the site. And the engineering department would also have a bond, but I've been involved with the engineering department. They have different criteria, and the money gets distributed back to the developer quickly. So, what you think is important and shouldn't be overlooked, the engineering department may have a different tolerance for that kind of damage or what's needed. So it's important, it's always important for everyone to understand that if you're passionate about a job and you want to watch it, it's come to the meetings, but then when the meeting's over, the work has just begun. I mean, you really still have to watch the job and let the people at town hall know if anything's going on.
It's in my backyard.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't...
Literally.
I mean, we can't react all the time. We're not your personal police department, but again, even though I'm there and we have an environmental monitor, it's always good to get some feedback. And we have email and voicemail and all that stuff, so...
One last follow-up, a little unrelated. Vegetation that we've all got right on the edge, is that at all in flood?
So... The vegetation that you have on the edge of your property line shouldn't be touched, but what's on their property line, if it's notated in the plan as an area that they're going to remove because it's yard waste or something like that, it's going to be taken out of there. This commission
wants the yard waste
part of it,
so it's not from a clean slate.
Can I just add, just in case it was part of your previous question, sorry to go back. The process here, they've submitted a permit. We are reviewing this permit. At the end of this, once we know the details, then we issue an order of conditions. In that order is referenced all these documents and all of our requirements for their work about everything they've submitted. So that becomes the working document that we have signed, and we've drafted and signed. And then that becomes their, what they have to be held to during the, before the project, during the project, and after the project.
One last question.
Evening, my name is Chris Nolte. I'm at 35 Plymouth Road. I'm the very last house at the end. Not more much of a question, it's more of a an observation, and I think I can speak for most of my neighbors on Plymouth Road, that we're still trying to comprehend how this really varies from the original plan that came into play over 2 years ago. That, and it's on record, and I know the committee has changed. Annika was on that a couple years ago. Chuck was a witness here. But what we noticed was that that plan was shown, and then it was, it's even on record. I don't remember who the committee person was, but on record they said if this plan was shown at that time, we would have turned it down. And then it was pulled off, and then 2 years go by, and we have a very similar plan with compromises. So, I mean, all I'm asking is put yourselves in our place. If these were your backyards, I think you would be very frustrated with this and very disheartened to know that we've lost some really good neighbors because they weren't able to do simple additions to their homes because they moved, and now we got a major development going in. So we're just not very happy with this.
I don't know the history previous to this application.
Yeah, I think that anyone pulled a permit back before we changed our bylaw would have run into some pretty tough rules and regulations. And we've changed. When I got here, there was a committee in town that was all about making sure that the commission had no teeth. And that could be part of the difference now. So anyone who has a house on Plymouth Road now, you should put in an application for your additions.
For sale sign.
Yeah. Whatever you want to do.
I don't find it very funny because I'm the one that lives there. So this is not fun for me.
Let me just.
It also sounded like you were saying we were just about to deny the project the last time.
I remember on record.
Yeah.
It's on record stating that if they pushed this through, it would have been denied, and then they pulled it off.
Can I finish?
Yeah.
I
don't remember it that way. I think that there was a question about the timing of the vernal pool and looking for some evidence of such a vernal pool. And we were in that season, and the commission requested, the applicant requested that they withdraw without prejudice. And we never came to a conclusion. So there wasn't any conclusion made. This is a very similar plan.
So I put in a deck, even on my deck specs from the town states, there's a vernal pool there. So that was 8 years ago.
No, I was going to say what you said right there at the end, Chuck, which was yourself, a previous member, and Mr. Manuel went out and investigated the vernal pool, the possibility of a vernal pool being in that wetland. That was pretty high importance to the commission at the time. And the standard to certify it as a vernal pool, although came close to that standard, was not met. So.
And it wasn't confirmed by DEP?
I think saying it came close, it was just not accepted.
Well, it wasn't accepted. It didn't meet the criteria.
There was no obligate.
There was no obligate species. There was, so the list of technical criteria needed to certify that as a vernal pool was not met. And even though there's chorusing in the area, but there's areas surrounded by lots of different wetlands, and other vernal pools are in the area. So, and that was a big part of the previous permit. But as Chuck said, then they pulled the permit and options stopped.
And what they're protecting is the breeding habitat. So we're not out there looking for the frogs, looking for frog eggs.
Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion to close the public hearing of NOI 270-0675 364 Lowell Street.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you,
Bill.
We have a continuation of Simon's Way. Continuation of a notice of intent, 270-0680, 1260 to 1264 Main Street.
I know.
Mass Equity Investments, and it's continued to March 22nd. And the reason is we had a couple site visits, one on Sunday, Mr. Curtis and Mr. Flynn.
And it was really cold.
Yeah, no, attended, and then we went on Monday at 11 o'clock with Chuck, Anika, Dave, and we had some, we did notice along the wetland line that, in particular along Main Street, that there was a depression near Main Street, and the wetland flags were appeared to be a little bit closer to the stream, and there were other vegetation indicative of wetland conditions, such as high bush blueberries and cinnamon fern, and there were also water stained leaves. We did take a soil pit. Just Chuck, who is the gentleman who was out there from the app? What's his name?
Oh, that's John Tilton.
John was there, and we did see a pretty robust, very dark, it looked like an organic layer, but there's a lot of sand in it. And then below that, right below that, there was sand. And it's very difficult to see any, what are called, redoxymorphological features in sand.
Yep, I've had three times fast.
Models. you know, the ferric oxides. Sometimes, and we you know, mucked around with the soil. We did see a few things, but we hit water fairly close to the surface.
Less than a foot?
A little more than a foot.
I think Harry and I had a lot of the same thoughts out there. And,
even further.
There were some flags out further out that I think we looked at and said, you know, this. I think Anika in her report had pointed out some of the numbers that we had seen.
Even further back, it looked like the small white pines were almost the dividing part.
Some of them were dying or drowning.
Yeah, well, they can survive in pretty wet conditions. But where we did notice it, there were a lot of high bush blueberries and some cinnamon fern, even further back there. One of you. Flags.
Yep.
Towards way back, towards Kirchian Woods, it looked pretty well defined because there was a pretty steep slope. So that's been continued.
So is there a next step on that?
We need to go and meet. We wanted to meet with the wetlands biologist for the applicant and ask him, you know, what was your deciding factor, and, you know, we'd probably take some soil cores while we're out there.
The 19th and 20th, those are just random dates. I'm sorry. I'm looking at chunks.
What about the 19th and 20th? Questions found on both March 19th and 20th. Was March 19th not the Sunday?
Today's the 8th,
no,
right?
It's
than they are.
Your dates
are
incorrect.
I was
not going crazy.
No, that's fine. That's fine. I wasn't sure if that was like a date that we had set for another visit. Or,
no.
Okay.
It should say March 5th and 6th.
Yeah, March 5th and 6th.
Yeah.
But that's just a note. I don't have to change that.
No. Yeah, that's.
Okay.
Sorry, Vic, do we have something scheduled? Or are we going to schedule?
We haven't got it scheduled. He was on vacation. The
okay.
Last
yeah.
Biologist.
We have to wait for that.
So, 7:20, notice of intent for 270-068114 Strawberry Hill Lane, map 7, lot 193, Moynihan. Is this a continuation or is this a new?
It's new.
This is a new. This is a public hearing. Is now open. And being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the written general bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing is conducted in the following manner. The applicant presents a proposal. Commission received reports from administrative tech advisors and other town departments. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. And when you do that, please give your name and address before your comments or questions are presented. all those that should have signed in to sign the attendance sheet. And at this time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Al Couliard.
Becca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
David Pinnett.
Jack.
I'm Jack Sullivan. I'm the representative and the engineer for this project. This project's is an existing order of conditions on this property. The existing single-family home is being constructed at this time. The owners of the house would like to put in an in-ground pool. It's going to be a saltwater-based pool with a patio surrounding and some retaining walls needed to deal with the 8 to 9 foot grade change from the back of the house to the rear lot line. The original order of conditions for this property, it goes back many years, as some of the members know. For the home construction, there was an order issued in 2009. We came in, I think, last summer, and the house under construction basically fit within the approved footprint on that approved plan. So the house construction was allowed to move forward. So really at this time, it's a backyard project. The pool, as you can see, it's going to be rectangular. And what we've tried to do is to keep the pool as far away from the wetland area as possible. So the orientation running west to east here, they wanted to try to retain as much yard area as they could. There were thoughts of trying to turn this pool, but then it would get closer to the wetland area. So the idea was try to tuck this in as far away from the wetland as possible. They are going to have a proposed shed here as well. Under Reading zoning bylaw, you need at least 10 feet from the primary structure to the pool. And you need at least 5 feet from the pool or shed to a lot line. So we really tried to tuck this in as close as we can to the rear lot line as possible. We have some grading challenges, as I talked about. There's a 9 foot grade drop from the back of the house to the rear lot line. Trying to be sensitive to the rear abutter, we didn't want to put in an 8 foot high, 9 foot high retaining wall along the rear lot line. So what we're doing is that there'll be a 4 foot high retaining wall along the rear lot line, and there'll be a 3 to 4 foot high retaining wall just off the back of the house. So that's how we're trying to balance that site slope. There is an existing boulder type retaining wall that runs along the existing lot line now.
Boulder as in like field stone?
Kind of field stone, but it's not. It's falling apart. I don't know if you've been out there recently.
Well, you saw a picture of it. It looked like a fieldstone stone wall.
It's fieldstone, but it's not like a nicely constructed one at that.
It's from when it was a farm.
No. I don't think so. No, I think it was from when they originally cleared the site.
Okay.
And they just pushed whatever they had back there.
It doesn't look professionally built to me, but So that's kind of what we were trying to do. We were trying to balance the site. The owners are interested in putting in some plantings as a buffer as well. That under the building code, you have to surround the pool with a fence, so there'd be a 4 foot high fence that's going to run from the back of the house to the lot line over here, and kind of close in this rear yard. I know there'll be many questions. I know some abutters have concerns, and we're here to try to work with that. One thing I should note, typically with any project I do, I try to provide drainage mitigation. This is unique in that in this site, when it was originally approved, the subdivision, they wanted water flow to continue to what was previously a vernal pool. Now it's kind of like a ponding area, but it was decertified as a vernal pool. So in an effort to maintain water flowing, I do not show any drainage mitigation for the pool patio. I show surface drainage moving out towards that pond area. We're open to doing drainage mitigation, but with my original design, like the driveway is captured, it's piped off to the back, roof drains are piped, water is supposed to be maintained to that pond area, so that's what we've tried to do in this case as well. But I'll open it up to questions because I'm sure there's many questions.
Can I just ask, so overall, how does this alter what was previously approved? So what was previously, in the previous order of conditions, does this build on top of what was previously approved, or?
Yes.
Okay, so can you kind of walk through that?
Sure. So in the original approved plan, which I was not involved in, when MBA Builders bought this last summer, I became involved in the project. There was an approved plan issued in that 2009 order of conditions, and there was a limit of work line about here, about 30 feet off the rear property line that ran across the back here. They show a tree line there in the original approved plan, okay? When I got involved, when I went out, the only two trees that existed, there was a 32-inch tree here and a 24-inch tree here. That was it. There was no existing tree canopy in the rear that I saw when I went out to do the survey. We came into the commission at that time. Those two larger trees were in an area that was going to be graded anyways, but we came to the commission, and it's shown on the plan that I did over the summer showing the 32-inch tree and the 24-inch tree to be removed. I didn't see any existing tree canopy going out to that rear lot line. Now, MBA sold, the new owners are here, MBA is building the house, but there's new owners. But the idea, thanks Chuck.
Is that helpful or not?
Yep, that's very helpful. This was the plan. What's overlaid in red is what I showed this summer. Everything in black is what was approved under the 2009 order. But you can see this area back here was to remain untouched. I don't think that happened. And the neighbors can talk about it, but when I came out and got involved in the survey, I had the two trees here and everything else was gone. There's some existing trees shown along the lot line here, but in the 2009 order, and it will come up, that showed that about 2,700 square feet of woodlands was to remain. So I didn't see that condition when I arrived on the job. I've talked to my clients tonight. They're new owners. They just want to move through with the pool. They're willing to do plantings, but they're coming into a situation. They didn't cut the trees. MBA only cut two trees that were approved. I don't know who did the previous tree work, but a lot's transpired on this lot that we're going to have to deal with now. But to put my client saying they'd have to revegetate this area seems a little extreme, but we'd be willing to come up with some sort of planting plan because they want privacy. The neighbors, I'm sure, want privacy, and we can do something like that. But that's the history on it.
That sentence, though, it didn't say, or was there a limit of work on the plan with the original, or that correlated to the 2009 order of conditions.
They don't spell it out, but right here is the limit of work. Because you can see there's no proposed grading or any work shown inside of that line.
Did you read that sentence?
And the only thing in the 2009 order of conditions, finding number 14, is a sentence to say, existing trees will be cleared from all but about 2,700 square feet of the lot.
No, so for what it's worth, though, I'll give my recollection of what I know, like what I recall of this property since it's been before us is prior to it being sold, it was up for an extension. And
right.
We had gone out there and we went out to see the site. And I remember you brought up the rock wall. I remember seeing the rock wall and I remember us seeing that this area back there had been cleared. And we looked at this 25-foot zone and said, nothing was supposed to occur here. The whole thing has been taken out, and there's this fieldstone wall now there. It was really a different site condition. It wasn't what was originally proposed. Now, I mean, that was, again, from 2009 to what was 2016. But I do recall looking at the plan, and there was issues with this that the commissioner brought up of have they been doing things out there that weren't originally shown on the order of conditions. At the time, they were looking for an extension to complete the project. It wasn't completed, and we provided an extension for that existing order of conditions. I don't know that we ever brought up a topic of the minor changes that were occurring. But the changes that had been occurring on the site. So.
I don't remember bringing them up when we approved John's project.
No.
I don't remember it coming up at the meeting.
Subsequently, then, yeah. So subsequently, the site was sold.
Right.
Another order of conditions.
Changed it, and we accepted it.
Yeah. Well, I think that,
in fairness, we're working
under an order of condition that exists.
So I think that. We're still operating, the house that's being built is being built under the order of conditions issued in 2009, right?
Correct.
And we extended that for
2 years? For one more year. Well, we've extended it a couple of times, but it's one more year from about last month.
So it came to us last summer, day before it expired, I think, and we were asked to extend it. And at that time, we looked at it and said, okay, we basically have a desert. Right, a lot had been bulldozed, cleared. So as I understand it, and I'm not saying this to be difficult, but the requirement for that vegetated area being in place at the end of this project is still in place.
That's exactly how I see it too.
That's, I would agree.
Well, that's the standing order.
That is
correct.
Now, it might have been taken down by mistake, or it might have been just shrubs. I mean, the builder said he didn't take down any major trees, but a lot of times these guys not the builder, but the light site guy thinks shrubs are different. It was an untouched area. So anyways, it was gone, but that doesn't mean that at the end of this project, before the certificate of compliance, that would have been revegetated. So we're really talking about changing what was asked for before. And before anyone makes their mind up, I think that we have people here that kind of lived through this since 2000 and whatever, and we should really hear their testimony too before we make a decision. But that order is in effect, and it says that all but 2,700 square feet in that back area will be touched or will be clear cut.
Chuck, there were other things in that order of conditions, like, you know, before they did any work, they were supposed to contact the administrator, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any kind of chronology of when that back 2,700 square feet might have been cleared, or?
I do not. When Mona, I don't know her last name.
D'Angelo.
Mona D'Angelo came to the commission and started it with her contractor. They did call me, and I went out there a couple of times, and I asked to have erosion control put in place. To my knowledge, I was looking at the back stone wall at that point also. I kind of a scrubby landscape, and I could see the stone wall. There might have been a few bushes in front of it. And then they proceeded.
What year was that?
What's that?
What year was that?
That would probably be 2013. Maybe late 2013.
So there was work already back there?
Yeah, I think it was kind of
in 2013. It was already cleared.
Okay.
Yeah. So, at what point it got cleared? I'm not sure.
Right.
And who cleared it?
Right.
It might have been the developer thinking that he had, he had a working order of conditions, and then I don't know. If it was the original developer, we could ask him, but I'm not sure at this point. Again, I think the testimony from the neighbors might be better than trying to guess.
In 13, when you were out there with the previous owner and you noticed the wall, did you bring it up? Did you say, hey, you weren't supposed to clear here? Or did you remember that was in the order at that time?
No, I didn't. My concern was a pre-activity meeting, erosion control, and limits of work, entrances, things like that. We're going to get going. We were dealing with this was a hotly contested problem. The owner was not too happy with the commission. All this stuff, it was kind of highly charged situation. So whatever the site looked like, they were given permission to move forward. And as part of the pre-activity meeting that I did, it was just erosion control, and then anything in the order would have been taken care of by the certificate of compliance.
Then maybe one of the abutters can speak to what sort of vegetation existed in that area. From this site plan, they show some of the larger trees that existed. Some are along the lot line here. You can see these bubbles are trees. And there's the two trees that we took down that we got approved for. I don't see any large trees noted here, but that doesn't mean they didn't exist.
Where was that tree that actually looked, didn't, remember we saw it and it was...
That was one of the two.
But that was the upland of the limit of work line. Okay.
Square feet.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
It was 80 feet.
That was right in this area.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So it was between the house and the limit of work. Okay. So it had been approved to take it down, but we came... Mm-hmm. Those are the two trees left standing, and we said we need to take those.
I think I sent it to you, but I don't think I saved it.
Okay.
How much you want to send it to me now? But it does show two trees right... This doesn't show those trees right here.
We added it, and you have a previous plan, but there was one 32-inch tree right here, and there was a 24-inch tree over here. There were two trees that...
And we approved that, and we were getting four trees back for that, and the original order asked for 14
shrubs on the north side, I believe.
Which are less than 3 inches and under 20 feet tall.
So the tough thing in this is if it was supposed to be retained, if I came in now for a brand new project with no order, I'd locate trees in accordance with your tree policy. We'd either give a monetary contribution or we'd plant back new trees. But in this case, I don't know what existed there. It's something that can be permitted. It's just dealing with the trees and how we deal with it.
I'd love to hear from the neighbors.
We have some pictures I got from the neighbors, which I'm hoping they're the right ones. This is the site.
Can you read on that?
I don't know if anyone wants to give a narrative, but their name first.
Your name and introduce yourself.
My name is James Wilder. Just to give you guys a little bit of history here. So I've been a butter for 14 years about, so I've kind of lived through the whole project. It's fine, there's going to be house there, right? That's not the problem. The problem was this was absolutely a wall of vegetation back here at the back of that property, and as the condition said, it wasn't supposed to be touched. When Chuck's talking, and this is probably about when they got the site here, about a year ago, right? But when Chuck was talking in 2013, there was multiple stages here. What they actually did was there was a field stone wall about halfway up there, and they kind of left that in place. And then about 2 years ago, they came through and they left the two trees, but then they regraded everything and actually raised the back of the property by 3 feet and took all the vegetation out, clear cut everything, right? Which was a clear violation of the terms. And I know that's a previous owner, but the work order should still, should still go past sale of property, right? And so at this point, it's those trees are gone now, and the property is raised up with kind of just some rocks holding the earth back there. I can tell you, I think Chuck, there might have been another picture of it.
There's
prior,
a couple. I can run through them for everyone to see.
Yeah, and there was a lot of smaller trees back there as well, and and during the summer that absolutely was 100% wall of green, right?
So is this where the stone?
Where's the rock wall in that picture?
This
is a picture without the wall.
The rock wall is going to be
right
there,
along the grass line.
Right on the grass line.
Your property line?
Yeah, that's my property line, right where the grass is. And there was another rock wall up there originally, which maybe that's what Chuck was talking about in 2013.
Yeah.
But this back wall here is about 2 years old at this point, where they came through and they clear cut all this stuff out. And this was, there was variety. Those are 6-inch trees, right? Those are pretty decent size. And they clear cut all that stuff out and then built it up by 3 feet and put that rock retaining wall into place.
What year was that?
That was about 2 years ago. And then the work on the site went dormant for, I've had a dust bowl back there for 2 years. Now we'll have a new construction there now. But.
So I'm just...
2 years ago, so MBA took on the project
last summer.
Last year.
So the grass is your yard.
Yep.
And that's looking up the hill towards where the house is being built.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
And how old is that picture?
That picture.
I have a date on it there.
Yeah.
Oops.
That one's off about.
Do you have dates on those pictures, or?
I don't see them. Any dates?
No. If you look at the files, maybe the file date. I don't know. Maybe when you saved it. They got to be, those going to be 4 or 5 years old.
That's 4 or 5 years
old. At the time of the order was issued.
It is Monday, December 8th, 2014.
Okay.
Might be when it was saved, though.
So that is the day they started the construction, actually, because you can see the truck up there, the tree truck up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the grass is your yard.
Yep. And you can see the hay bales. See that black right there? This is is where they were trying to protect the back of the order, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so they did have that up at this point. None of this stuff was supposed to be touched.
And then they broke through it?
And they broke through it. And so that day is when they broke through it. They clear cut the whole thing, raised it by 3 feet, put the rock, dumped a bunch of rocks back there to retain the soil, which I don't think is probably good enough. But as you said, it's falling down. Someone said it's falling down. It's not a high quality rock wall. But yeah, so that all happened 2 years ago. They just blew right through the order. And then they sold it, right? And so now it's not their problem anymore. But still kind of blew through the water, it's still an actual issue, right?
So the order of condition still stands for that original project is what it was under. And the two trees, that was, just so I'm clear, that was a minor plan change? What did that end up getting submitted under?
It's a minor plan change. It's actually, okay. It's a minor plan change.
Those were massive trees, right? Yeah. The two property are massive trees, right?
But there's a number of them. Compromised.
Absolutely. I understand those were not going to survive, but they were also compromised when dirt was piled up 4 feet around their trunk, right? But the rest of the trees were, they're medium-sized trees. They're not tiny, right? And there was a lot of them. Huh?
Right.
My recollection is when we went out there a year ago to consider the extension, there was a tree, and I suspect it's the one on the right. One to the right of that?
That was dead, right? Yeah. So I understand those coming down, right?
Okay. Because when I first went out there were several enormous stumps. And this was a site that had some really enormous trees that were taken down. And even looking at this...
That's halfway done already.
This is halfway done because... The order was issued in 2009.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, that's made clear cut. Just when we got up, we noticed what was happening. We took some pictures just to make sure we had a record of it.
Can I just ask the abutter one question? Did you call the town when this took place, or what happened?
Yeah, I sent an email. I'd have to go back and look at my records, but I did mention it, and I said, hey, it doesn't look like the order is being followed here. I went digging through my records to try to find the order, I didn't have it, but I said, you know, I believe I called, when did you take over, Chuck? Was it Fran before?
5 years. I was here. If you called, you would have talked to me. If you emailed Fran, I don't know where that went.
I might have emailed Fran and just blown, you know,
yeah,
might have black
her email from before.
Yeah.
The only other thing I want to say is, if, let's assume the silt fence is where the limit of work line was approved. Just, it may be, it may not be, but it looks about right from here to the edge of the grass. There's really not that much. You don't see large trees in that area. I mean, they did go into that area,
yeah,
but
that's in the corner of the property. If you look at the other end, if you look at it from the other angle,
is there another
pan,
another
yeah.
view?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I don't know if I have another picture from that time.
It doesn't look heavily wooded to me, but
yeah.
maybe.
But this was also.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at all that stuff on the right there, I mean, that goes off for more, you know, for another 10 feet
this
as well.
This is also 5 years after the order of conditions was issued.
Right.
It looks like there's a pile of wood debris that's, I don't know, maybe.
That looks old.
Yeah.
Is that yours or did they pile that up there?
Yeah, I was there when I got here, when I moved in.
I mean, this picture, I don't know, maybe you can
years.
Tell us, but this picture
yeah.
looks more or less like what the original condition probably
that looks,
was.
Yeah, that looks more like it. Yeah. That's a good representation of it.
Like, this certainly exemplifies the need for a tree inventory, as we've had in other projects that have come before us recently. You know, because in this here, when I look at this plan and I also look at this order of conditions, there's nothing in the text and there's nothing on this plan that indicates where that 2,700 feet is. It also, to be quite frank with you, it says will be cleared from all but about 2,700 square feet of the lot. It doesn't anywhere say there that 2,700 square feet shall remain uncut, untouched. You know, so there's really no caveat there that says this is going to remain pristine.
I agree.
It's sloppy. The whole
thing's
sloppy.
When I read that, Dave, you know, and Chuck and I discussed that, It said it talks to the trees, the mature trees, and it doesn't say where that 2,700 square
right.
feet is. But
right.
but now that you folks have pointed out that original plan, now I can kind of
I'm
see.
I'm guessing it from the original plan.
I
know.
You can see
it
from the hay bales they put there. I mean, that was the intent to protect that.
So
yeah.
Dave,
yeah.
Al, explain that to me a little bit more. What you mean by that? When you say, when it says all but.
It says here, it says existing trees
that could be
will be cleared from all but about 2,700 square feet of the lot.
And what don't
what 2,700 square feet? Where is it located?
Not
we'll
just
take
that.
You know,
it doesn't say what.
It doesn't say
where the 27
that
2,700 square feet.
Not necessarily where it doesn't say all but 2,700 square feet, because that area is to be preserved.
Right,
but
what that does, but what that does
to build
say,
the original house, they didn't need that 2,700.
But so
square
where's 2,700 square feet on here?
But what it does say is there will be 2,700 square feet of trees.
But so,
correct,
but
which
that's
is now
what I'm
gone.
Is,
but it doesn't really indicate where that is. You could actually say that 2,700 square feet was in front of where the house is.
Okay.
Next to the street.
But
so
that 2,700 square feet in the front of the house was taken down.
Right.
So
I don't dispute that.
Okay.
But the thing is it's like, it's now after the fact, it's very difficult to say, okay, where was the 2,700 square feet? Are we going to throw a dot at the lot and say, well, this is where it is? You know, you would assume that it was in the buffer or the area that's between the neighbors, that was what you would assume, but there's no
I would
there's
like
no tree inventory here. Right.
This 2,700 square feet is been determined to be a no-cut zone.
Right.
Or
it didn't.
I think David's point's a good point. This was a finding. There was a finding
yeah.
that about 2,700 square feet of trees to remain. It wasn't set up like 30 feet from the rear lot lines, a no-cut forever zone.
Right.
But
I think it was more, if you look at it, it's a finding. It's not a condition that's to remain. It just says this is a finding, this
mm-hmm.
2,700.
Sir, your name and...
Yeah, I'm Charlie Wilder. I live on Ash Hill Road, which is the next street over.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody knew where the property, where they were supposed to protect, because somebody put a black... You can see it
yeah,
on
we
the,
see
the,
it.
The
yeah.
So the developer or the whoever was doing the work knew that it was 30 feet. They put that barrier up, and then they protected it for some period of time, and then they just just totally wiped it up.
Was it the same developer? Was it the same crew, or?
No, it was under the same owner.
It was under the owner.
So who did it? I don't know who actually did the work.
We don't know who did it.
It was under her ownership. It all happened.
I think with the limit of work line, and an area behind that, I think it's pretty self-explanatory where the 2,700 feet are. I mean, I don't think we need to. It's silly to.
I think
to
it's
go back
it's,
and
it's sort of all rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic at this point. So.
It is. went through a great pains for some period of time to protect that area. And then, for some reason, they just blew right through it.
No.
But the other thing you also have to look at here is where that hay bale line is not where the most mature trees are. The mature trees are actually uphill with that.
Where the house is built. So
where the house is built.
That's
that's 2,700 feet.
I don't want you to think I'm minimizing, you know, the situation that occurred in the back of your lot line. If that happened where I lived, I would have been really ticked off if that happened in the back of my house. And I would be very disappointed if it did happen. The thing is now is that we're left with the situation is now what do you do 5 years after the fact? Who did it? Where is it? You know, and there's really, we don't have anything at this point that is on a plan or even in the written order of conditions that we really can definitively hang our hat on. I don't think that's true.
There's a work area line on the original order of conditions. I mean,
you got to say you because I don't know if everyone agrees. But
yeah,
if you say you, fine.
Right.
Keep talking. But coming from where my experience is, that is the erosion control limit of work line. The 2,700 square feet is right there. It's close to the pond, which was thought to be a vernal pool. Mm-hmm. It was probably habitat for wood frog. What's that?
2009. It was decertified in 07, right?
Right.
Yeah. We're talking about where the commission's head was.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Right.
So we have vernal pools.
It's still
we have potential vernal pools. Yeah, you can give it up on the state, but you can still deem that it's a potential vernal pool. Just because you think it meets the criteria, you know, under your own regulations. So,
but isn't it isolated land subject to flooding as well?
It is.
So it's jurisdictional.
That criteria, yeah.
So.
I mean, at this point, this is a new application. What's happened has happened. And I think a pool is something that can be approved. We're open to doing plantings. I don't think this is set in stone that this is never a no-touch zone ever again in existence. The planning board didn't ask for that. There's not a easement established or a conservation restriction area over this area. There's ways to mitigate for it. If I was going to come in on another site and I showed 10 trees to come down and I planted back 20 or gave a monetary value and I met the setbacks and performance standards, there'd be a new order issued.
Putting a pool on top of it within 5 feet of the lot line and all the hardscape and lot associated with that.
That means zoning.
Yeah. I mean,
So
because we permanently injured the property, we can then just go ahead and put.
Let me ask a question. What would you like to see there, if anything? What would your solution be to this? Put yourself in our shoes.
Yeah, I hear it. I think a reasonable solution would be to put vegetation back on, you know, in that spot, right? And vegetation that's going to grow. So that's trees as well as, you know, lower ground cover. I think that's what was there before. That's a picture in the fall. If you saw a picture in the summer, you'd see, you know, pretty well dense, you know, trees and vegetation back there.
So is there some sort of compromise we could reach with that?
I think there are other people that want it. Is there anybody else that wants to?
I think at this point, I mean, we got to get the testimony in from the audience and whatnot. There's this permit, there's two additional permits, and there's a lot more in here than just one, you know, three words, you know, 2,700 square feet. It talks about a planting plan, which as I'm listening to you guys and not taking my minutes, found in here. So maybe that would add to it. So I would really recommend that we take this as far as we can, and then everybody try to get as much information on those two other plans. I did send some stuff to you, but there might have been holes in that stuff that I sent.
When did you send that? It was pretty recently.
2 days ago.
Okay. Did you guys look at it?
So, I'm not sure that I think that most of us agree that that 2,700 square feet should have been saved, right? But it wasn't, and there's a new house there now, and you can't go back. I think it kind of goodbye. So let's.
That's not how things work.
I think we should make No.
That's not how it works.
I think we should make a compromise to get the 2,700 square feet back.
You're mixing two things together. I would say clearly, if this pool didn't come up, when the first order came to the commission, they would have to replant that area. No question about it. So at the very least, you need to decide on this pool project, assuming that that's habitat and it's fully planted, because we haven't accepted this, and that's what the old order would have made that other person do. Plus, where are you going to put all the trees that are missing that I see in these pictures? The 14 shrubs and the 4 trees that we asked for before. We're running out of space on this lot.
I thought the 14 shrubs were supposed to be in the...
north of the house. That's what it says.
North of the house. So along this lot line. And it looks like there is some area...
south of the house.
This is north.
Yeah, both sides, I'm saying. Okay, yeah. Right in here as well.
There's a pretty substantial area to the north of this where it shows the construction access, but only really on the upside of the house once you get the retaining wall and then the bluestone patio in there. I don't know what you could put between that. There's not much space. In the pool area, but certainly up in the upper side there is.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah, I want to know.
And
how far out do you have to get to 27?
81.
81.
Is this, the other thing is that, do you know, in not just on your property line, but the other property lines to the abutters, is all of the trees along the front?
This is 30 feet from
all the trees gone?
Yeah, basically there's a couple still at the front, and then there's a very small one still in the back corner. That's maybe 2 inches or something like that.
So they kept a couple of the larger ones up front?
Sorry, Chuck, what do you want me to do?
I'm not sure who's going to tell you.
I'm not sure whose property that's on, whether it's them or the next 30. There's a little pump at the front.
Okay. You had a comment. Could you introduce yourself, please?
Bill Renskid, 18 Maple Ridge Road. Really a kind of a clarification. My understanding, if I heard it right, is this currently is under an active order, and that shows this area not to be touched, etc. They then came in and requested a minor amendment to take a couple trees down, but that order of conditions is still current, correct? Mm.
And those trees are outside of this area.
This firing now, is that intended to be a superseding? Is that intended to
it's
be
a
modification of
no, it's a,
this
it's
filing?
A totally separate
it's
filing.
It's a brand new application. Yeah.
And that can happen even though you have an active order of condition?
Yeah.
The two would stand alone.
Right. Even if they look like they're conflicting in the same areas?
Yeah. Well, so
that's what we're discussing.
Well, it's not to not approve things that conflict with each other.
Yeah, so that's part of the discussion of this application.
Well, that's what I'm confused about. You know, how can you, if you have a current active order of conditions that will eventually need a certificate of
compliance,
you have this one, though. I understand that this was going to be a superseding one. That's one thing, but how can you have two over the same area that could potentially be?
So are you wondering if we make changes on the existing order, how would we justify that, or how would we line up the two orders?
My question is, how does this have standing if you currently have an open order of conditions covering that same
It's not
area?
Covering the same piece of property. They're working in a totally separate area. The work on the original order of conditions is outside of the limit of work. This is inside the limit of work, and the other one's mostly about the pond and drainage in the house.
Chuck, they do overlap.
And another thing, and I don't know where you're going with this, I did already call DEP, and it's fine. So I don't know where else you want to go.
So they do overlap. They would conflict in certain ways. Yep. I think a change to the existing order of if something were to happen, a change to the existing order of conditions would have to occur so that it reflects it. Because how can we issue a certificate of compliance on something that doesn't get met? I mean, that's all conjecture. That's assuming...
You have a multitude of possibilities.
Yeah,
You can say you don't accept this, you want to add it to the old one. You can say that you have to finish off the old one before we would entertain this.
Mm-hmm.
You can take the old order and amend it.
Exactly.
To allow this.
It can occur. I'm just trying to understand
how...
It can occur, but I think you said it perfectly. Right there, you just said it perfectly. There are a lot of different options that can occur with it, but two applications can occur, and two notice of intents can occur.
One of the reasons to have a new order was to try to eliminate all the history on the site and the craziness, and just to focus in on that one area. Not think about the house, but think about, you know, where the pool is going and what it actually is going to affect. I think that it does that, and instantly we've identified, you know, something that might be a holdover from one of the orders. And I was just looking through this again, and there was a bunch of questions on the commission, where's the 2,700 square feet, and how do we know that that's the area and all that other thing. And as part of one of the conditions, it says no activity shall occur beyond the limit of work. So,
and to add to what Chuck said, we spoke about how to do this filing, and one of the main things was the original order is from 2009, 7-8 years ago.
Yeah.
So, Chuck said, I want a new filing for this.
Yeah.
It makes sense. We re-advertise, we re-notice the butters, we bring it in. Is a difference, and it's not something like, you know, this order was 1 year old, then I would look to amend.
Yep.
And do it. In this case, it's 8 years old. Even though it's still active, it's so outdated there might be new neighbors, it sounds like some are not new, but we wanted to reintroduce this as a whole new project and bring it to light, and then you guys can decide how we should move forward with it.
Yeah.
So what's the status of the house? Is it it's complete?
It's being framed. It's under construction. I think the framing's complete. It's under construction.
So I'm thinking if that 2,700 square feet had never been disturbed and this application was before us, would we say that the previous notice of intent forbids us from allowing any clearing in that 2,700 square feet?
That's a great question, but that's also a question we don't know how to answer. I mean, right, it can say that on the previous two orders of conditions. There was one for the whole development, and then there was another one and there was a couple that was denied too. So there were things that happened, and didn't have time to research those. I also, like I said, I sent those to the commission. So say this was set aside for wood frog habitat, and they agreed to it, in some other order it is protected somehow. Well, then we would know the answer to that with a little more time to investigate. And then if not, you just have to look at it as a forested area that is outside the 35-foot, you know, fairly far away, and didn't have any ongoing restrictions on it, which I think you're saying that might be what it is. But we don't know which one it is at this point.
Don't you think it's also true that when the subdivision went in, this was the sacrificial lot that they didn't build on, and they left forested, and they kept treed, and it was adjacent to what may or may not have been a vernal pool. And so you build the subdivision, then you sell the lot, then you clear the lot, then you say, well, there's going to be trees in the back. You sell the lot again, and you say, yeah, there's no trees left. And then you say, all right, we're going to put a pool there. And all of a sudden, the original intent of protecting any wetlands associated with that entire subdivision is completely eliminated. So I think to say to Al, I guess the way I react to your question is, if we were looking at this today with the trees in the back,
you know. I'm just wondering if there's anything that would restrict us from allowing them to clear those trees to put in the pool. I mean, we'd have abutters who wouldn't want us to, would have to make those decisions like we do at every meeting. But is there any specific language that says that there's a wetlands restriction on that, this area cannot ever be cleared?
I think that has yet to be determined. I don't disagree with you. I think it's a good point, but I think it's yet to be determined based on all the data. I think there are challenges associated. Take everything else away. I think there's challenges associated. Assuming this was a treed area, there are challenges associated with filling, with grading that all the way back there. I think there would be a lot of questions associated with this project separate from everything else.
Yeah, those challenges of filling, and I mean, with that house in place now, you know, it almost makes it physically impossible to get those rocks and dirt out of there now.
Can I add one thing to what Michael said?
One of the reasons why you might want to do that, sorry.
Go ahead.
Wood frog habitat would use the ground at its original elevation to use for our breeding.
Right.
Wasn't?
But it's not. It was decertified. And so what this is isolated land subject to flooding, right? And what's the performance standard for isolated land subject to flooding, which is flood storage?
Yeah.
But it could be an isolated wetlands as well under a new bylaw. So
I'm just saying you don't have to just go there. I mean, this is always going to be, in my mind, a potential vernal pool, all right? So that's kind of where I'm at. And you said, what are the standards? I think the standards that we need to meet increase in this area, whether it's been decertified or not. It was, back in the day, a certified vernal pool.
That should have...
I can pull the sheet and show you what's in there, and they didn't fake it.
No,
so what happened? Well, something happened. And you know what usually happens? Someone messed around with it.
Right.
The upland gets decimated because the vernal pool creatures don't live in the vernal pool. They live in the upland. So when you develop the upland, surprise, surprise, the upland habitat is gone. If you don't have a permanent home, you don't get anything that survives to go to the nesting site. So it's well documented how these vernal pools get
today
decimated.
Today, as that sits, it's not a vernal pool.
No.
That's correct.
That's correct, right?
I actually remember when it was a vernal pool.
It's not a vernal pool today.
Right.
So I just wanted to say something to what Al and Mike said. So to try to reconcile these old order of conditions, when one order was set when it was a vernal pool and you're protecting so many feet from that vernal pool that will remain wooded and untouched, that's why this lot wasn't built on. All of it was going to stay flooded.
Exactly.
Right.
So to try to go back now and reconcile an order from 1995 to 2002 when it was a vernal pool.
No.
But we do have a standing order of conditions from 2000.
We're trying to do the history.
I don't think
we have.
There's a ton of backstory in this lot.
Right.
It's a lot of history.
So,
but in my opinion, we've got an existing order from 2009 that has a whole bunch of very specific
conditions
written into it. If I'm going to consider this plan, I want to know how those 2009 conditions are going to be met.
Why didn't we say this to MLB when Jack came in and got this plan modified?
Well, what are you talking about?
What do you mean? He came in with a minor plan change to take out
two trees.
No, and he changed the house, the footprint of the
house.
He
made it smaller.
Yeah, I know he made it smaller, but at that time, why didn't we say, hey, you know, you cleared and filled this 2,700 square feet. How are you going to take care of that?
I don't know if it's
we let them,
was
we let them build the house,
no,
and now we're going to say, you're going
to
take the rocks and fill out of it.
They didn't fill it.
It's not up to
there's
us.
There's still construction
to,
equipment back there.
You
right?
know, it's not up to us to make sure they understand every little bit of the contract they got
we
into when they
do
bought
a
this
good
off
job
of Mona.
Of making
so
sure
that's
all
not,
applicants know what's going on.
They have the order of conditions that was recorded. They have a lawyer. That's more than this commission has, okay?
Right.
So it's not up to me to run through this for them. I think that you're siding with your
with, you know, I'm not going to say it, but I think I see that very clearly.
You say whatever you want.
I think you're siding with your business, all right?
I'm not
siding
with my business.
A little bit, and you want to exploit it, and it's not true. And you're not even seeing beyond the fact that, hey, this is a new project, and, you know, there's more here than just you know, taking down a few trees.
So I think this is sort of the legal interpretation, which is pretty easy and not much fun for anybody. And then there's the fact that a bunch of neighbors all have to live together. So is there anybody else that
has a
point of view?
Yeah, that's why I asked what he wanted to see there.
Can I just ask a simple question? Dave, let me just finish my thought. Is there anybody else that from the community that wanted to say something before we digest this any further?
Okay. I just wanted to ask a question.
Can I say something? Sorry.
Oh, sorry.
My name is Christine Woodian. I am actually one of the new owners here on Strawberry Hill, so it's nice to meet all you guys. Heard lots about you. I completely understand, and a lot of this is new to us. Obviously, there's clearly a lot more history on this lot than we ever knew. We never knew this when we bought it. We simply saw that MBA had the piece of land. We went to them. We asked to buy the piece of land from them. We then hired Jack, because we know Jack is very well respected in his industry as well as the town, to kind of work with all the engineering, make sure everything is done correctly and to a T. We're not looking to cut down trees we're not supposed to or do anything that's not within all your regulations. We came at MBA and asked them to if we could move forward with a pool. They asked us that, said we should go with Jack to do our engineering with it and to do a separate new application for this. And I completely understand Mr. Wilder's point of view. If I were that neighbor and had to deal with this for all these years, I mean, I'd probably be going crazy as well. But our ultimate goal is to make something that's going to make all the neighbors happy. We want to plant trees back there. We want to bring back kind of the life to it. We don't want to be looking in everyone else's windows. So we're willing to do what you guys think is appropriate to make this work. I mean, we, like I said, vernal pool, no vernal pool. I don't know. We were not involved with this. I would just ask you guys to keep an open mind of what's there. And we are absolutely willing to work with you guys as well as all the neighbors to get the privacy back, get the beautifulness back, because certainly when we did buy the land, it was a dust bowl. There wasn't one tree on there, and the rock wall that's back there now is beyond hideous, and we want that gone, and we want to make something beautiful, and like that's we're here to work with everyone, and we understand you have a job to do as well, but
can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Before you bought the house, did you read the order of conditions?
I did not.
Did you know there was an order of conditions on the property?
I personally did not. That would have to be a question for my lawyer.
One of the things I have is just it might be an oversimplification, but I just gonna throw this question out. Can we continue with the existing 2009 order of conditions, those portions that are still valid and enforceable of that 2009 order conditions, and create a new order of conditions that incorporates the pool into it with mitigations for the filling, for the wall, and for the trees that were cut down that would mitigate what has been done on this lot to bring it back somewhat to where it should be.
I think, well, let me just simplify your question. Can we have two orders of conditions, and can they both get certificates of compliance? I think they can. I know they can. So we can write one for the pool and ask for, you know, 14 shrubs, 4 trees, and whatever those other trees that are missing. Yeah, we could. I mean,
well, the 4 trees and the 14 shrubs are part of the 2009 order conditions. What I'm saying is just continue with that. Those are already there, but then add to the new order conditions for constructing the pool that would mitigate some of the things that happened on this lot that were not supposed to, that were outside the window.
I would expect it to be exactly like that.
I would like to see how that would happen, because my understanding of the previous order, and I think I need to go through the previous order, the 2009 order.
It was sent to you 2 days ago.
Yeah. I looked through it.
Again. Again. Is that previous order kind of maxed out the mitigation. So I'd like to see how that new mitigation would fit onto this lot. I don't know if you...
I know we're not supposed to do this, and Al and Dave usually do this for us. Could you turn the pool so that it is not so close to, I'm sorry, I forget your name.
James Wilder.
The back property line.
The property line back there, and have some natural vegetation along towards the wetland resource area along the south side of the house.
We can do that. The idea would be getting closer to the wetland.
You'd be making it more natural. And what I'm talking about is the limit.
More of a buffer to the neighbor.
Yes.
I understand that.
You'd be giving, I'm sorry, your last name again?
Wilder.
Mr. Wilder, a little bit of a buffer here, and then you would be giving the people with a wetland resource area a buffer to make up the 2,700 square feet.
To make up that 2,700 square feet, Becky's got to get 33 feet.
I will never make up the
2,700 feet is basically the back property line to the work zone line. I mean, that's
feet
all right.
Yeah.
Almost to the house.
Line is like right
it's 30.
Right.
It would be 33 feet from the property line, which, if you look at the original plan, I mean, that's probably right where the proposed erosion control.
Why?
Is.
Well, I don't know if you could or couldn't. It would be really.
33 by 82.
I got like 40 by 60.
Jack,
so the back property line's 80.
So
maybe I should.
So this is a one.
Sorry, I shouldn't be doing this, but
we did look at different alternatives how this pool could be laid out. Our idea was to try to keep it as far from the wetlands as possible.
Why?
But we're open to. We may have to look at it if we want to give the neighbor more of a buffer, if we can. But also, to be fair, if you look at this picture, which is a great picture, I'm glad we have it, because no one knew it existed out here. The reality is, if you counted up the number of trees under your tree policy that are 6 inches or larger,
how many are there?
Six. No. This wasn't like they took. This area was to be retained, but there's really not much growth in there.
Assuming that that's what it looked like in 2009 when the order was issued.
This was 3 or 4 years ago. I don't think any work took place back here. I think that's what it probably did look like.
I don't. Yeah. There's these mature trees in front of that.
So the reality is, there's not that many mature trees that would qualify under your tree policy to begin with.
I don't think that's the point. I think the point is that the 09 order says that 2,700 square feet was that's going to be it. Addressed before. My suggestion would be to withdraw this. And if they really want the pool, come back to us with a plan that addresses the violations, is really what they are, in the 09 order. How are you going to address those? And you're going to address those, and you want to do a pool. That would be my suggestion. I don't know how
I hate to withdraw. I'd ask to continue just so I can think about it, because
okay.
They did. They have their filing fees, they notice the butters, they paid for newspaper
that's
ads,
fine.
They
right.
paid
that makes
me.
Sense.
So I'd ask to continue just so I can talk with my clients,
okay.
See what we can come up with, and then if we had to withdraw, we could, but...
I'd like to ask Ms. Monahan a question, if I could.
Sure.
On the south side of your lot, is there any plan to vegetate that area, your border, the southern border of your lot?
Can you pull up a... Just so I'm clear what you're...
As you're facing your house, it's the left side of your house.
The site plan.
Where the vernal pool is.
Over here?
Yeah. Well, overall,
yeah.
One.
All the way up to the street.
All the way up to the street. Because there's quite a bit of area outside the 25-foot line up on the south side of the house that you could also vegetate and plant
yes.
trees there
so
as well.
Our plan in working with also
MBA and whoever we choose to go for with the landscape and the hardscape is the plan, or hoping with your blessing, is to also on that south side, so where that hard line is on the left side, plant some additional trees, shrubs, and also have maybe bring up the get rid of the obviously the field stone wall that's at the bottom, and perhaps put on that line there, and also put trees where you're talking about in that far left corner. We obviously want to try to maximize as much yard space as possible, but we're trying to also kind of close ourselves in for privacy reasons and not have to do a large brick wall or anything, or a large fence, anything like that. We want it to be as natural as possible, but we also want to maximize what we were told and sold as yard space and told and sold as usable, you know, area, and hopefully a pool and a nice yard to go with that. But yes, our plan is to absolutely add additional trees and shrubs and go for as maximum privacy as possible.
So my only other thing as well with this is, you know, I would like to think about ways to make up that difference there. I would also, you know, I know this was, I think this got added to the site visits late. I don't know, we didn't end up going. Did you guys do a site visit?
It wasn't even on the list.
No.
I think. Okay, well, either way.
It was.
What's it?
It wasn't the site visit.
I think it was on the site visit list. On the ones that got sent with the packet, not on the ones that got emailed to us.
Yeah.
I think it got added later. I think with all things considered here, I think I would like to go see this site again. I would like to see where things are being proposed. I think it's great to see it on a plan. I think there's perspective is always helps out. Where the corners of the pool is relative, the house relative, the property line relative. I think that will help as well, and I would like to understand more what could be proposed to make up that difference of what was removed in the back there. Assuming you want to continue.
I would like to continue.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that's my
motion.
Move we continue this notice of intent.
I second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jack.
Thank you.
I'll tell you one thing it reminded me of. We have this clause in here that says when you turn over your property, they're supposed to send us a notice that it happened. I don't think I've ever seen one. It's just recorded on the deed. Can you imagine your lawyer not telling you?
I do, actually.
Always comes up.
Why should it
continue? Should.
No,
it should.
Yeah, that's why it's there. Yeah.
Well, that's what I was saying.
Okay, folks, can you take it outside? We got more business to discuss. Thank you.
I mean, but you're the one making it seem like you don't want
to. No. I want to.
It's enormous, but we don't need to consider.
Hi. Your name? Which project?
95 Walkersburg Drive.
Put some mitigation south and north of the house, and I think you get there.
Okay. We have a certificate of compliance. Let's. Can we go out of order, Chuck?
Yes.
We have a certificate. Excuse me.
I thought he was with that group. You had to sit there and listen to that.
No,
yeah.
You're having a blast, aren't you, Frank?
I am.
Certificate of compliance for 270-403, 2003-29, 27150, 2003-13095, Walker's Brook Drive. We did get some information.
But it's really quite simple. We have one here, and not much explanation is needed. There's one for 1986-13. That's obviously an attempt to do a bylaw-only order of conditions, but it was recorded. There was no work done. I recommend that the commission sign this, and we have one here for.
I would like you to explain it more.
Wait a second.
There's
no
work.
Let's just
sign
with
your no, no work.
Let's sign with the conservation people.
There's 95 Walkersburg Drive, 270-150. Again, it was an order of conditions that no work happened on. It's been verified. Dave and Mike went out and got me that information. I recommend the commission sign that.
Harry, ask. Go ahead and ask.
Is this the brick office building
yes.
next
to it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
I just like to know what property I'm looking at first.
Oh, okay. And then we have 270-403, and then RGB number 2013-29. This was the water? Is it the water project?
Sounds water main.
Water main project. We all remember that going through. So Frank was caught up in a project that had an easement through his property. So just like everybody else in town, when they try to get their orders of, when they get their house refinanced or they try to do any kind of bank transaction there, they catch that. So we're issuing a certificate of compliance, but a partial only for his property.
We don't issue partial.
What's that?
I thought we don't issue partial.
Yes.
But I did that
old.
Caveat only if they're 20 years
I
old. I knew what I was going for. So I recommend that you sign that too. And while those pens are juiced up and ready to go, we have a different property, but I'll wait till we finish off on this one so I don't make it too confusing.
It's really bothering you, isn't it?
Mika stole my chair. I thought I was co-chair. I thought I got a promotion. I thought I was vice chair.
Would you like to be vice chair?
No.
All right.
Could happen, man.
I think I can handle that.
So I think we're all, you're all set?
So you have to, someone has to make a motion.
I make a motion to sign all three orders of conditions.
Certificates of compliance?
Certificates of compliance, I don't know, sorry, thank you.
Second.
All those in favor?
Thank you all.
You're welcome, I'm sorry I had to sit through that.
When can you pick this up, Chuck?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, you can, are you trying to get out earlier than, I told you 10, but I might be able to do it earlier if you need it.
You want to just call me when it's done?
I'll do that. All right, Frank, thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Good luck, Frank.
See you on the field?
Yep.
All right. Thanks,
Jack. Yep. All right, to keep it rolling, I'm just gonna continue on. What, there's one more certificate of compliance
how easy it was for
that we have to work on tonight, and it's for.
Just
got rid of it.
No, that's continued. There's no paperwork or a fee filed.
Is this for the Pittman Drive?
No,
right. It's for 95. Thank you. It's for 95.
36.
36.
And I just misplaced it. Where'd that go?
Never started, never completed.
There you go.
Okay.
And what was that supposed to be on with it?
So I went out to the site and verified no work had been done. This order of conditions was issued to do a garage addition with a bedroom above it, and that was clearly never done based on the foundation and the fact that there's a garage still there and all that. So I kind of verified it. Do you have any questions?
He's
looking at me like,
so we can't sign this because they didn't give the check for the.
No, this
no,
is
this
a different,
is different
one.
This
Dave.
One's all set. So 36 Pittman, 270-66. I recommend that you sign. No work was completed, making the order invalid.
So are we signing a certificate of completion or are we signing?
Compliance.
Compliance.
Stating that. It's the order of conditions is invalid. This checkoff box is
invalid order of conditions.
And no work was completed.
Is this a request from the applicant?
Yeah. They're selling the house.
They're selling.
I make a motion to issue the certificate of compliance.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, Chuck, what's next?
Okay, we got them all signed. We got one.
Three.
The one for Artists Senior Living Center.
Now I'm gonna
111.
Wait on that.
Main Street. Chuck wants to wait for the to do a site visit when there's some vegetation, right?
I want to wait to get into the springtime and ask them for the...
Is that the replication area?
Yeah.
So did they do some more work there?
They have not. No, I still see open house signs over there. A little bit of business from last week, although we did vote to close and approve the Reading Rifle and Revolver Club, we need to sign the orders of conditions. The same as I presented to everyone last week, it just was never signed. So I don't think we need a motion.
There's no motion here, it's just signatures.
Just signatures.
So did we need to vote on those last two, not this one?
This one was voted on at the last meeting, and...
We voted to close the meeting.
We voted to approve and sign, and I reviewed the video, which is quite clear what happened.
I'm just trying to understand.
So even without meeting minutes, we were able to get it done.
What's that?
I'm just trying to understand how sometimes I just get confused.
Well, it just slipped away. It didn't get signed. It was overlooked.
No,
we got talking about
talking
something
about
else,
just,
but I did review the video.
That's not what I'm talking about. I'm just unclear why we signed the other two and we required a vote, but we don't need it.
Because we voted on this last week.
We voted last meeting.
Chuck, let me ask you a quick question. Was
on a different thing.
Is that?
Do I look heavy on video?
It was on that particular project.
I was going
to
ask
the ones that we signed, and we didn't have to vote today.
Sometimes I'm the only one that
cares. I got to tell you, there's no way I'm even spending any time wondering what you're looking like when I'm having to review this.
What about 21 Hunt Street?
21 Hunt Street, I prepared that order of conditions, and...
Which one was this?
That was also with Jack.
Oh,
so
I did
Jack's on that.
Well, that was the garage?
Yeah. So I went out to the site today, and I don't know if anyone ever went out to this site. It was on the site visit walk. Did you?
I did.
Yep.
I went out.
Okay, so maybe you can confirm what I saw. I saw a lot of yard waste, and I saw a lot of stumps in the wetland. I've written that into the order of conditions to have those removed before we're going to sign this. It's the order of occupancy order.
You're going to have the stumps removed?
Yeah.
So how come we hold the occupancy?
Oh,
they're pulled out. They're just.
I thought you were pulling the stumps out.
No, debris.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Okay. But I thought the same thing.
And it did look like there was been a lot of clearing
he
going on down
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
Okay. But
we know what he means.
I didn't.
I was wondering what other people thought of that.
You can read through it.
You mean downslope of their driveway?
Well, there was that. It was downslope of their driveway. There was a couple of trees, and all of a sudden there was a cleared area.
I was out there, there were four-wheeler tracks there.
I think we see that a lot when I went to look at...
Well, it was, no vegetation, no trees. Here we go.
But there was also like a foot of snow on the ground, too.
Well, not today. Today it was no vegetation, no trees. Just looked like it was just cleared out. And then, you know, obviously I saw all those stumps, so I was wondering what if it was...
They were willing to remove stuff at the other...
Yeah, they said they were.
See the big pile of, like, sticks and...
Actually, they were blaming it on somebody else, weren't they? Weren't they saying that other people...
You know, as long as it's out of there...
The left side, too.
And the only other question I had, and Jack's not here, was around the garage and the rain garden. It seemed to me that the rain garden needs to stay in perpetuity for two reasons. One is because it's part of the reasons we're agreeing to this, so it's one of the conditions. And secondly, they have maxed out their, they're in the Aquifer Protection District, and they have to compensate for the difference in volume, whatever, I don't know. So they've maxed that out. So if that ever goes away, they're in violation of that condition. So I also put that in here, too. So those two things were added to basically, which is pretty much a standard order of conditions.
That didn't get mailed to us 2 days ago.
And I think you need to close and I'd like you to close and approve again just to make sure.
That I make a motion to close 21 Hunt Street.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
I make a motion to approve the order of conditions. For
second.
All those in favor?
go by a copy of Robert's rules tomorrow.
Aww. Oh, isn't it cute? What's his name?
Luke.
Luke.
Luke Christian.
Oh, nice.
How old is he?
He'll be a movie star.
How old is he?
7 months.
Oh.
Is it anything?
Is that your daughter's name?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, bought a house on Pinedale.
That one you were showing us a little while ago?
Yeah. So, I get this strawberry plane bot in my head. And
I'm not sure.
Let's keep going.
If we want to keep going, then we can circle around, because there's going to be talk about the MACC stuff, and then you can talk about strawberry.
Strawberry.
Yeah.
Minor plan change to 18 Spring Street. No, Salem Street.
Brent Street.
Salem.
Dungeon.
So they're proposing to change.
Whoa.
That the guy with the wall close to his house?
Yeah. Yes, yes.
So what's the change now? Did we get a plan for that?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think I saw it.
Yes, we did.
It's right in front of you.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is this yours?
Yeah.
Okay.
You can look your shit.
He's looking out for you.
He is. Every now and then.
Well, now that we're roommates over here.
Taking it to the next level, there you go.
This is being recorded.
Separation.
Now he's
going to
get a call from his wife.
Stop talking.
I don't know either.
Yeah, I kind of went through this with Becky or somebody. I think it was Becky.
No.
Maybe. Oh, it was Anika, and she didn't understand. Someone didn't understand it, so I realized.
It was Dave.
It was
Becky.
So I thought we didn't want the patio extended any further
like
for
Becky.
Purpose.
Close the glasses.
I really wasn't paying attention.
Do you use curlers, Dave?
What's that?
Do you use curlers or not?
I don't.
This is the proposal, and believe me,
my hair is
if you don't understand it,
we're not paying attention.
I won't disagree with you that there's a it's a little bit hard. He had a nice color one. I don't know what happened to that. I came back with a couple of these ones. So their property. We understand that we have this area, which I would call the okay buildable area, inside the fence, grass, lawn, all that there.
That's not okay buildable.
Not buildable, but
usable,
passive recreation. And we have this area out here, which is, plantings and nothing else. So what they did is there's a fence that comes along the back, and then down here, and I think you can see it went right to the house.
Yes, I can
right
see
here.
It. Yep.
But now they want to have access to the side yard, which makes a lot of sense, and I think it came up in the meeting. So they want to extend it down in this area here, and then bring it across, and there's going to be a gate here.
Okay.
So they were previously going to put the gate in
this area here. I think
they were going to put it in just above the existing shaded deck.
Right.
Okay, I don't know if there's... So
no, I have that on my plan, that's where they were going.
To answer your question, I don't know if we're eliminating any gates, but I know with this plan change, they're asking for a gate right here. That doesn't mean anything else is going away.
Oh, so they might have two fences.
They didn't tell me. That's a great question. Maybe we should ask them. Secondly, what they want to do...
Go to the one on the bottom first, and then deal with the patio.
This here is kind of like a land mass up against the house, and they're saying they're having a hard time getting out, all right? So they want to make this remain, and they're going to remove this.
Turn it into pavement?
Pavement or gravel.
I don't have any problem with that.
Explain that one again. I'm sorry.
So this is like a high mound of a hill, or like retaining wall next to a set of stairs, and they just want to create a little bit more room to swing in. I don't know and back out.
I think there's even a couple of ties there.
But it's becoming
a safety issue, and, you know, based on where it is.
Okay.
That's the least of our problems. This one, we talked about it, and the deck is up there already.
Mm-hmm.
You see the deck right here? And what they want to do is, this is a paver patio. They want to extend it to there.
So not a deck, a paver patio.
Need a paver patio.
I thought we approved a crushed shell patio up there.
Yeah, I thought we wanted something. I didn't think we want the area bigger, and I thought we...
I remember part of the discussion on this is that the corner would have been in, and some portion of it, excuse me, was over the 35-foot line.
Right, that's why it's curved.
And
this is the original retaining wall, which was 35 feet away from the original flag.
No,
25 feet?
25. I think it was crossing at some point. And we said it was we said they could rebuild it because it was grandfathered in.
Right.
It was there, and we just wanted it back to the original condition.
The 35 goes under the corner of the deck.
There are parts of the house that were inside the 35.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
But they give them.
I don't have the better plan. With, actually,
I've got one.
It's
if
on this
you
one.
Want to see it.
I do.
Can you? I can put on the original plan if you want.
So, this.
That's 35.
Is that the 35 foot?
Yeah. 25 and 35.
Oh, okay.
Oh. Oops. I'm sorry. I missed your proposed patio.
Well, if they're gonna put patio into the 35. Can ask for mitigation for that?
Well, I think what we said was we were already...
What's mitigation at a site that's the whole thing
the
is...
Whole thing's
additional
mitigation.
Plantings.
Yeah.
I mean...
I think what it is we said you can't put pavers in. You can put crushed shells or some other pervious surface.
Did we really say that?
I thought we just said pervious
impervious
pavers.
Not crushed.
I don't know that we necessarily said the material to be used, but I think something like that.
Yeah.
Something pervious.
Yeah,
it's pervious.
But not pavers.
Yeah, I do recall pervious surface.
So even if it gets a little bigger, I mean...
What's wrong with pervious pavers?
It's not impervious, it's pervious. It's
it will
sort of
allow
kind
water.
Of
if I'm saying it backwards, I apologize.
What? That's it. I didn't mean to snap.
No, it's all right.
So I'll just... Gonna start. The first two items, I don't have any issues with. Just to.
It's actually better.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think it makes more sense. Just to get those off.
Because
someone
the
else
on
if
top
anybody
of the
else
wall,
has a disagreement about that.
In on the out the wetland side of the wall.
What's that?
It's gonna be
is the fence going on top of the wall, or is it going to go in on the wetland side?
It's not going to go on the wetland side.
And it would just be right the same height as the wall.
Yeah.
Do we care what kind of fence it is?
This is going to be the extension of what we already approved.
Is that like a...
I think it was vinyl.
Vinyl, 5 foot vinyl type thing. Okay. 6 foot vinyl.
I think the whole thing's fine. Should we just make a motion to approve the minor changes?
Do I hear a motion?
What's the material of the patio?
Pervious pavers.
Pervious pavers.
Make a motion to approve the minor plan change at, what is it, 360?
218.
218 Salem Street.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you.
I'm not going to do a Jamie Wong on you.
What's that?
What?
Oh, no. For building specs on the pervious pavers.
No, no.
Anika, I got a present for you.
Got one for you, too. What is that?
I don't know. My engineer gave it to me. It's something about the standard water standard you were asking about.
He does think about you.
No, I just printed that out, actually.
Oh, you did?
I have it here.
Oh, okay.
Is that the basis?
I'm asking
the
difference.
The design.
Oh, I just got something
design.
On that.
The
well,
stormwater.
Send it to me.
Design.
Okay.
You want that?
Thanks. 26 Nelson
Good.
Avenue, where there was no paperwork or fee, and we just talked about the artists. Do we have a short debrief on the MACC conference? Anybody like to?
At least how was it, Al?
It was awesome this year. It was even better than last year.
How was the food?
Food was good. The bartender didn't make a very good margarita, though.
Well.
It was a little weak.
Yeah.
So which workshops did you go to?
I went to the How to Expedite a Meeting workshop. Very helpful. Step number one was firing Chuck.
Man, if anybody wants these things to roll, it's me.
All right. What else did you attend?
There you go.
He's waiting for the video to come out.
I'm waiting for it to come on Bay's review.
Yeah. This guy's made me
good.
Yeah. What'd you see?
I went to something about enforcement.
Wetland enforcement basics.
Wetland enforcement basics. And then I went to one of the ones that I really liked was legal insight to wetlands operations, and it was a lawyer that actually his practice primarily is in wetlands cases and so forth and protection. And one of the things he came up with that was pretty shocking at first is that everyone that was in the room, when he said, you know, are you covered under, indemnified by the community you work for? Because he said that there was someone down in Braintree that was held personally liable for a situation that arose down there and was sued by the developer, who actually was in the wrong, but still sued the individual that was on the Conservation Commission and won a $75,000 judgment against the individual that was on the Conservation Commission personally, against their person.
It's always been my understanding that you can only do that if you sue that individual for violating your civil rights. It doesn't really have to do with the commission of the town. You have to prove that that person in their capacity as a building inspector or a commissioner or a board agent violated your civil rights. There's a bunch of successful.
It wasn't actually civil rights, it was a procedural thing. So he asked to find out, and I happened to ask one of the selectmen the other day, and he said, "Oh, I'm sure you must be." I said, "Do me a favor, check that out, would you?" But then I went to an open forum that actually moderated by Jennifer Steele. She's the
Framingham agent.
Newton.
Oh, she's a Newton.
Yeah. Oh. Very good. Very, very good. Very knowledgeable. You know, I'm sure the breakout session could have gone on for 3 hours. It didn't quite get to everyone's point, but it was a wide breadth of questions.
Mm-hmm.
So it was good. I enjoyed it.
Did you go anything?
Yeah, I did. I went to 2 talks. I saw the keynote speaker. It was about where Massachusetts is heading with climate change impacts. That was sobering again.
Did you have the keynote?
Yep, the keynote speaker. He was keynote address was Professor Primick of Boston University. I can get into that in detail later, but the workshops I went to a workshop about low impact development, and it was a talk by both Horsley Witten Group, a principal there, and the Town of Framingham Planning Board Administrator, and somebody from Mass Audubon, and it was all about setting up community-wide from planning to bylaws to engineering low-impact strategies and greener strategies, that it's more cost-effective, it's less pavement, so it's less construction cost.
I've been trying to do it for about 15 years now.
Engineering. And and I was given some great handouts to share in the town. I gave them during the site visit on for Main Street this week. I gave them to Julie, the town planner, assistant town community development director, town. I said to her, I said, you know, I've tried to push some low impact strategies with some of the wetlands permits, and what I heard from the previous town engineer was, yeah, we don't do that. And she said, yeah, that's the old way of doing things. She said, I'm very much on board with low impact development and low impact strategies. And I said, well, here's a bunch of handouts as to why it saves us money, both in construction and in long term maintenance. She said, I know. And I said, well, if you need paperwork to show anybody who needs to be convinced, she said, I'll definitely take it. And I'm going to hand another set of the brochures that Mass Audubon put together to engineering when I meet with them. But the neat thing about Stephanie Covino, I don't know if you're familiar with her, Chuck. So she is the coordinator for Shaping the Future of Your Community program, long-winded, through Mass Audubon. It's essentially free planning support and plan review support and regulations, policy implementation support. So, you know, somebody in the meeting said, what can I get for free from all of you who presented today? And Stephanie said, me. You can get all my consulting services for free to plan your low impact development strategies and to get that moving. I was like, well, that's
helpful. You think
helpful.
He was a plant?
Huh? Probably.
You think they set that up?
Like really a green plant or? Yeah. So the other talk I went to was about, surprise, surprise, reviewing wetland mitigation plans. And it got into the nitty gritty of how do you know the soils that come onto the site don't have invasive species. Because when they add that soils to the wetland replication area, you know, here's the standards you need for your soils. Here's the standards you need for your plants. Did you know that nurseries in Massachusetts can hang on to a plant for 2 weeks and then re-tag it as being original to Massachusetts? You know, it's where actually it came in 2 weeks ago from North Carolina. You know, so there are all these, this one speaker went through his specs and said, this has to be in your order of conditions, and this, and this, and this detail, and do you know the planting season, and do you know that the soil they bring in, it has to be one part compost, one part loam, but one part sand, you know, and so I'm just, you know, and so it was way too much to take notes on, so I asked him to please send me the presentation. Because it was going to be 2 weeks before MACC posted it to their website for me to look at and review. And I knew with Lowell Street, that replication, that was coming up fast. So I said, can you send that to me? And he said, yeah, give me your email. I'm traveling, but when I get there, I'll try and send it to you. And sure enough, true to his word, by Sunday night, he sent me a huge presentation of everybody's slides from that talk. So that was really helpful.
Good, thank you.
Yeah.
To piggyback on that, one of the things that came up is a limited impact development. They have something down in Plymouth.
Yeah.
That it's, I guess, something that is being hawked in the not only in the Massachusetts but also in the New England region, the Eastern Seaboard. It's 3,000 acres and it's 3,000 units that are going on the 3,000 acres. But I think 62% of the 3,000 acres is maintained in open space.
Yes. Yes, and it's the oldest road in America.
Yes.
Yes, that one.
And the construction costs are less, the residents are happier, and they're also doing high energy efficiency units. So,
it's a lot of low impact development that people at the town level said, no one's ever going to buy this. Yeah. Who wants to live? One of the low impact developments was three townhouses sharing one driveway surrounded by acres and acres and acres of beautiful land on top of a hill. And all the townspeople said, you're out of your mind. But the developer wanted to do that. but the townspeople, all the people at Town Hall said, it's never going to be sold. It's not, they sold like that.
Yeah.
Because it had the buffer. And that's what people want. They want their, anyway.
Some do, some don't.
Some do, some don't.
Okay.
So I learned about fluvial geomorphology.
Awesome!
So I went to the enforcement basics, and the one lesson that the one thing I learned there is when you agree to a minor plan change, be specific. The example that was given was a house with multiple plan changes right on a pond known as a reservoir in Canton. And the conservation commissioner in Canton presented. And when the applicant said, I want to repair the riprap along the pond, she said, okay, and he signed off, and then the applicant went and built a 2-foot, 3-foot tall retaining wall and replaced the riprap along the water, and she didn't have a leg to stand on, so that was her lesson learned, was be specific when you agree to minor plan changes. Because it's really...
He also built it over...
Well, he did a lot of other things, too.
He built that stone wall
over a
sewer easement. But one of the things that in that same thing, I don't know whether you took this away, but it just popped into my head, that one of the things that the lawyer that did that said is don't ever change an enforcement order into a notice of intent. Never, 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 never. He said carry out the enforcement order, bring the enforcement order to fruition, and then once the enforcement order has been satisfied, then do a notice of intent, because once you do the notice of intent, the teeth of the enforcement order are gone.
That's exactly what we did in Yonjin. That's how we did it in Yonjin. It worked out really well. So the argument was, if the enforcement order requires the applicant to file a notice of intent, they file the notice of intent, you release the enforcement order,
right,
and now you have nothing to enforce. You just have an NOI, which they may or may not
proceed with.
Well, you can enforce the NOI. It's recorded on the deed.
No.
Well, you really can't because it's...
Can't you issue another enforcement?
You can.
I'm not sure you pass...
I wonder if it could be...
You can't get around
it. You got a due process issue there.
Yeah.
So, anyway, so that was that. And then,
Okay, I'm tired.
Well, you can enforce the same activity every day.
Hazard.
So you can write an enforcement order every single day.
We learned all of our tickets.
Fine.
We want tickets for
$300 a day.
So I guess that you could turn around and just enforce it again. Yeah, it would be funny. Did you understand why you would, you know, why you would release the enforcement order? Was there any positive to doing that?
No, I think what she was saying is some people have done that and it just doesn't work, so don't do it. So it was just a lesson learned. And then sort of piggybacking on the keynote speaker's discussion about the coming Armageddon, it was pretty depressing. You know, I think it highlights the need for us to be up to date on how much rain we expect in a 100-year storm, get that number locked in, and then, because it's expected to go up. And then the other thing is, supporting river smart communities, we had the people talk that took the dams down on the Shawshene River in Andover, and they talked about all the infrastructure they had to deal with. Really interesting, but I gave Chuck the brochure they had, which was really good on
stream stats, stream crossings.
Yeah, stream crossings. So how to, and I think that's just a really good reference document for us to the extent that it comes up, where you've got culverts that need to be replaced with the new standards, and we're getting some really good examples of why that's important to protect habitat. Let the critters swim
over
the salmon, crossing the find the salmon cross the road. Show meet his girlfriend.
So the synthesis of the keynote speaker was, if you want to experience what you've traditionally known as New England weather in the next 30 to 35 years, buy land in Canada.
Yeah. In 40 years, we'll have the climate of North Carolina, according to this guy.
I hope so.
I hope not.
Al, you're not going to be here.
I'll be dead, but I don't want to be cold in the ground. I want to be warm in the ground.
We have no emergency permits, no bills approved, and what about the minutes?
No, I
vote we approve all minutes.
Yeah,
to take it.
I vote to approve all the minutes, but let me send them out again.
Again?
Did anyone review them?
Did you get them?
It's really hard, Chuck. I'm not criticizing. It's really hard when you get
did you send them?
Three meals a day for 3 days, and
sorry.
You can't remember which is what.
I sent them Monday.
I don't believe you did, Chuck.
Shit.
I don't know. I seen them. Sorry, I did look at things.
I looked at them. I thought they were perfect.
I thought they were out. I even asked Dan to get them again. All right, I'll send them again. It's Monday's the same.
Change.
No.
Did you want to wrap up on story?
I don't really.
Can you make a motion to adjourn?
Did you want to say something about strawberry?
I don't know. You know me. I'm just looking for a compromise and an answer.
Hopefully that's what they go back and do.
I mean, you know, that guy, James, should have a decent buffer. Hopefully he can get to 25 feet or so and give us something on north and south of the house.
You're really not supposed to discuss it without the applicant here.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to talk about
stuff in general.
General stuff.
Okay.
You asked about Strawberry Hill. What do you want to talk about Strawberry
Hill? I didn't know. Well, I didn't know you were going
to
talk about
strawberries and Strawberry Hill.
Second.
Helping.
All those in favor?
Figure to the Beatles song.
What are you going to talk about?
All right.
I'll stay.